Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the Town of Deerfield Selectboard meeting being conducted as a public meeting place at 8 Conway Street for April 20th, 2016 at 6:40 in the town of South Deerfield. We had a hearing that was supposed to start 5 minutes ago, and I apologize for that.
Please go ahead and read that whole.
Go ahead and read it.
Public hearing notice, yes.
Oh, sure. I'd be glad to. The Select Board of the Town of Deerfield will conduct a public hearing on April 20th, 2016 at 8:40 p.m. at the Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, for the purpose of receiving comment on the recommended changes to Chapter 35, Section 23 of the bylaws of the Town of Deerfield. Recommended changes would amend the necessary requirements for a department to authorize shift differential pay for any non-exempt employee. The complete text of the proposed bylaw revisions is on file with the town clerk at the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, Deerfield, Mass., and is available for inspection during regular business hours of the town clerk and can be found on the town website at www.deerfield.ma.us.
Thank you. That's why you get to read it, because it's so much nicer. All right. You're presenting this one?
I'm happy to present it. This is, and I'm actually just trying to find some information for you. If you want to grab one and pass it over, this is a copy of the, an updated copy of the special town meeting warrant. And if you open it to page 6 of 9, you will see the text of the proposed bylaw change. A little bit of history. This bylaw change came about through a series of conversations that I had with Zach Smith, the town clerk, as well as through with members of the Board of Selectmen, of course. It's intended to clarify language, and it's intended to bring the dollar amounts in this bylaw in compliance with our current collective bargaining agreements. Previously, the bylaw was interpreted in a variety of ways. It required basically a litmus test as to whether or not a person was full-time or part-time, and whether or not they were regularly being scheduled for a second or a third shift working position. And it was being interpreted in two different ways depending on what department you were talking about. In one case, the person said, it doesn't matter if the person is scheduled for a third shift only once in any given year, I'm giving them the shift differential. In another department, it was being interpreted as only my full-time people who are scheduled for a second or third shift get a shift differential. So there was unfair treatment across the board. What this attempts to do is it attempts to put the litmus test, if you will, on the onus of the department. It basically asks, does a department schedule someone for a second or third shift at least 4 times a week for at least, I think, 40 weeks per year?
36 weeks.
36 weeks per year.
Okay.
Basically 9 months.
And that meets the contract, the police contract requirement?
Well, this won't necessarily affect any collective bargaining agreement that the town has with any entity, but what it does do is it helps to regulate more cleanly when a department head is required to put in for a shift differential for an individual employee.
I wasn't sure about that 36 weeks, did you say?
36 weeks per year.
Yeah.
So this wouldn't affect, for example, a poll worker who comes in and works like a 3 to 11 shift twice a year for an election or something like that. It wouldn't affect a library that only has a couple of night shifts, for example, per week. And it wouldn't affect folks going out doing snow plowing on irregularly scheduled shifts. Okay. It would only affect those departments that regularly schedule people from 3 to 11 or from 11 to 7.
Okay. Is there any public comment on
that's
this?
That's the expectation.
Jeff, do you have any public comment on this at all? Okay. I guess we can close the hearing.
I move to close the hearing.
That's it.
I second that.
Any further discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Close of hearing. All right.
That's it. And that'll be on the special town meeting warrant next Monday.
Can I ask what you...
Well, these are the cost checks. They're here for the bid.
Oh, for
which
the bid.
Which is later on down the agenda.
Do you want to... Is there time for that?
Kelly Claffey from Pink & Company is here. If you want to talk to her about things.
So I believe we've provided Doug with a letter to the select board. Quickly, I'll read it for everybody that's here. On April 12, 2016, Bid Docs Online received 6 prime roofing bids for the Deerfield Elementary School roof replacement project. The bids range from $1,589,000 to $2,042,000. All came in well under the MSBA approved construction budget of $2,341,276. The low responsible bidder is MDM Engineering Company, otherwise known as MDM. Their bid, $1,589,000, is $276 under the construction budget, a significant savings to the town of Deerfield. Pink conducted a detailed review of the bids, made reference calls, visited the DCAM office to review evaluations, and provided a bid tabulation, which we've also provided under a Dropbox, a 26-page document, delineating the bid results. Overall, MDM scored very well, scoring highest in the categories of workmanship and change order processing. Paperwork and coordination categories, however, received lower rankings. Both PCI and RDA have worked with MDM on projects of similar scope and size and are keenly aware of the challenges related to these categories. PCI and RDA will work diligently with MDM to meet critical milestones and deliverables to help ensure a successful project. We therefore recommend the board approve MDM and authorize PCI or Pink & Company to proceed with the contract negotiation award. And so we've also provided the notice to proceed for your team to sign off on.
Which I have here.
I just was a little uncomfortable on the add-ins. Do you know how much the add-ins are going to cost extra?
The unit costs that are delineated here in the unit price section 01
to the $1,005,000.
27. So those are unit costs that are delineated, and each one of the contractors had to include the bold items on this section in their base bid. So the bolds or the scopes, for instance, the first unit cost, cost per board foot for replacing deteriorated or unsuitable wood nailers and blocking with pressure treated type specified. In the base bid, MDM has included 500 lineal feet, 2x6, above what is indicated on the drawings. So each unit cost has an extra included, which we would reconcile if they do not.
Well, what I was a little bit uncomfortable is, I didn't know what the additional, can you give us just in a ballpark what the additional would be? Obviously, hopefully, it would not be $700,000+, but what did you, so we have $1,005,000 plus these add-ins.
No, so these add-ins are included in this 1.5.
They're totally included. Okay.
The bold is totally included. The unit cost above and beyond the bold, they've given us, so if we encounter more than that, that would be reconciled with contingency.
Okay.
So can you give us an example of that?
So for instance, the first one says they have 500 lineal feet of deteriorated, unsuitable wood nailers.
So that's what they're expecting to do for their base bid. Is they're expecting to encounter 500 lineal feet of deteriorated?
Well, whatever's shown on the drawings that RDA had gone and done their cursory review.
Yep.
Plus they added, if you want to call this an allowance or a guesstimate of what they should include, that's their RDA's best guess of what they should have on top of what the drawings show. So not only do your drawings encompass the scopes of work, but then we said, okay, let's put X number of lineal feet included in the bid documents. So if it's 502, the contractor could ask for 2 linear feet more and would use the cost that's in their contract terms.
So what I was wondering is just ballparking, we're talking a small amount of money extra in your mind, or is this potentially big bucks?
It should be covered with the contingency.
Okay.
And the contingency for the project is, you said,
about 10%.
117 is what's reimbursable. It was 200,000 roughly.
Yeah,
and so then you have another 700 and 752,276. That's contingency, but not all reimbursable by MSBA. Does that make sense?
Right, but by going with the lowest bidder, we're not anticipating much beyond the $1.5 million. So I just wanted to make sure you felt that the additional costs that they've, you know, listed,
right,
would be part of the, you know, would probably be less than $200,000.
RDA takes a crystal ball, and based on the site reviews that they've done, they try to protect the interest of you and make sure then we come up with these unit costs, again, to protect the interest of you,
okay,
moving forward. And this is our best guess estimate of what we think the scope should be. But if it goes on top of that, your contingency should cover. And if it doesn't, we're going to notify you right away.
Okay.
But again,
based
on what the site reviews that RDA has done, we feel comfortable that we are covered.
Okay. Then I'm okay with it. Did you have any questions on it, Mark?
No, I read it. I have no questions. We just want to see how it plays out.
Okay. Well, then I make a motion that we vote to approve the proceed with
letter
contract.
Letter to proceed.
Letter proceed, okay. With a project notice proceed.
Oh, there's a motion. Motion's on the floor, seconded.
Yep.
Any further comments or questions about the roof project?
What?
Yeah.
Oh. I made a motion that we would move ahead with a notice to proceed. Notice to proceed with a contract based on our assurances that the 1.5 was a reasonable amount of money, and the additions would probably be included in our contingency amount.
So it's just meeting now we're approving the school contract? Is that—
This is the DES roof. Yes.
It's for the roof. Yes. It's for the replacement of the roof. Yes. We're approving the opening of the RFPs for the roof. They've been tabulated and all the information is here in Town Hall. They've been reviewed by Dick and hopefully a consortium of people, Doug, myself. I think Carolyn probably reviewed them all.
I did.
And basically it seems to be in order at this point in time. This is a formality to make sure that anybody else that has any input that they'd like to put into it gets a chance to speak up.
So this is for the RFP?
This is for to continue on.
It's for contract now to move
for
forward.
Contract. It's to move to the contract stage.
Yeah.
Because this bid came in at—
I was looking at it. I mean, I'm sorry. I'm coming in from the outside and I don't know a whole lot what's going on.
What we went out to bid.
There's three people approving a $2 million contract. I wonder if that's sufficient.
Well, there's Dick.
Not that you're not intelligent people.
Well, town meeting approved the contract in January at the special town meeting, and they approved an appropriation of $2.968 million to go to the school roof.
Right.
What's being approved now is simply the bid. It's the low bid for the primary construction, which came in over about $750,000 under expectations. And the understanding is that if there is any additional costs, they're going to be covered by about $175,000, $200,000 contingency. So our expectation in signing this notice to proceed is that the construction will be $1.5 million, maybe as high as $1.7 million. And of course, the other costs for the OPM and the clerk of the works and so on and so forth on top of that. But we're looking at a substantial savings from our expectations.
But to answer your question, the people we hired to look at this and propose this and make these documents for us have reviewed them and are putting their stamp of approval in reviewing. They went to the state regulating board for people who do work. It's a DCAM certification, which means the state looks at these people and they get letters from whether they've met their requirements from doing other projects, that also that they've had affiliations with them, and the fact that basically we found no negative response in our search for the ratings, so to speak. So we went and actually did, through our clerk of the works and OPM, a review of other projects to see where they fell apart. Basically, what was reported out, in case we're not speaking loudly enough, is the fact that they are great at doing the job. They're kind of a little bit lax in the paperwork to follow up with it. So they're really good at their performance, but the actual documentation to get to the DCAM certification is not as good as people. It's not a 5-star rating. It's a 4.5 or a 3-star rating. But the work is good.
So we're really good at your paperwork. So, and they're really good at roofs. So we have a pretty good
partnership
team
that will make it work. So
my concern was that they had listed some contingencies already, and I wanted to make sure that we weren't talking a lot of dollars.
Yeah. So these though, the unit, are you talking about this sheet here with the unit cost spread? So the unit costs are set up for you in anticipation if there were any ads, that they can't go use anything more than this. Again,
but I just wanted your reassurance that you felt, in your estimation,
yes,
that there was not any huge surprises. We weren't talking a huge amount of money extra, and
I think
I
RDA
okay.
did a good job putting in what they thought needed to be covered and basically produced on their drawings, and then with the allowances that they set up. So that would be above and beyond that.
That was my only question, is I didn't want us to have a lot of, you know, we're $750,000 less. Mm-hmm. That's great, but then if we add in 500 or 600,000, it's not such a great thing. So, but if you felt like it's within our contingency, which is fine.
And we've asked those questions, you know, a lot of scope questions in our evaluation of the low bid to make sure, because it's lowest and most responsible that we would recommend to the town. And based on our conversations with the scope, we feel they have what it takes to have it, the budget covered.
And I appreciate very much that you are willing to chase the paperwork, because for us, this is a huge investment, and we want the paperwork absolutely in order for our warranties and everything else. So.
Okay. Any other questions or concerns? Seeing and hearing none, I'll take a motion to, or all in favor of the signing of the letter to proceed? Notice to proceed.
Aye.
On the replacement of the roof project. Second that.
Oh, you have to sign. Just you, I think.
Heather, you do that. Thank you. You may take both of them, actually, if you'd like.
Sign as many as you want.
I've got one copy here, so if you want to sign and keep one. And then...
Yep. I think he's got about three of them.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, I just was prepared. Sure. Very excited.
We'll hold one. There you go.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And we'll see you guys on the 18th.
Today's
day. All right. Thank you.
Sure.
Let's go black. Let's go blue.
Oh, right.
Gone.
And just as an overview, the PFA is supposed to be executed by MSBA this week, so then we can execute the contract moving forward.
Two, three.
Great. So you, are we?
Yes.
So you can start as soon as school's out.
Yes. So we are starting. We are starting with the paperwork process tomorrow morning.
Perfect.
So we get this scanned over to them.
Thank you. I really, really appreciate it.
We're excited.
For the bids, and that's what Vern's here for. So we can go down to the bids if you want. Down on parcels for sale. Or bids. Which one are you, Doug, which is the one you want us to jump
the note, you should have, if you're looking at the property for sale, the award of the bids.
Okay.
You should have documents there, I hope, please. I apologize, I think I've got them right here.
I wanted to organize us on this.
Yep, okay.
Because we have a couple people here who are very interested.
Who are very interested in learning the results. I'll read from a memorandum sent to the Select Board from the Town Administrator's Office dated today. On March 10, 2016, the Town of Deerfield issued a request for proposals for the sale of town-owned real estate in accordance with the provisions of Chapter 30B, Section 16. The deadline for responses was April 16, 2016 at 2 p.m. I think it was April 15. It was last Friday. Four individuals reviewed all proposals as received. Each reviewer scored each proposal based solely upon the published criteria and the response. The responsiveness of each proposal was also considered. In the case of a tie, the town administrator reassessed the submitted proposals against the evaluative criteria and determined the most responsive proposal. Responses to each criteria were scored with a numerical assignment. An advantageous earned a score of 3, a not advantageous earned a score of 2, and a disadvantageous earned a score of 1. After evaluation of all criteria, a final score was calculated by adding up these individual scores. Award recommendations were made on the basis of the evaluative criteria and not on the price proposal. That's in accordance with the terms of the RFP as published. Bid prices were not taken into account during the evaluation. As a matter of fact, they were not opened until after we had completed our scoring and had determined potential awardees, if you will. The results are as follows. For the Coates Avenue lot, that's map 168, lot 21.1, I recommend the award of this bid to Vern Harrington, Thayer Street Associates, he having submitted the most responsible and responsive proposal that will be of the greatest advantage to the town. I don't know if you want to do these together as one lump sum or...
Well, why don't we do them together?
Okay. So that was that. In regard to the barn on Jewett Avenue, map 169, lot 168, I recommend that the board reject all bids. Map 88, lot 1, Upper Road, that's the west side of Upper Road, I recommend the award of this bid to Mark Whiteman, I think it's pronounced, the company is Futures Unlimited, he having submitted the most responsible and responsive proposal that will be of the greatest advantage to the town. And map 88, lot 2, that's Upper Road, that's the east side, I recommend award of this bid to Joseph Koscheck. Did I pronounce that right? I hope yes. I did. He having submitted the most responsible and responsive proposal that will be of the greatest advantage to the town. I've attached to this memo a blank scoring sheet, which is the scoring sheet that the reviewers used, as well as a tally sheet of all the bids that we received and the price for those bids.
Do you have any questions, Mark?
Any questions or concerns?
I make a motion that we approve as recommended. Yes.
List as recommended by the.
By the town. Yep.
I'll second that. Any further discussion?
Nope.
Concerns? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Very good. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. For 8 to 10 years. I appreciate it very much.
I'm sorry, Vern. We really did try to address this earlier.
No, I know. I'm very happy you
did. Very good.
Thank you again for all your efforts. Really appreciate it.
Well, I'm glad it worked out. Did you have any questions at all, Mr. and Mrs. Koscheck? Okay. Doug, what's the next step for them?
The next step is that each of the recipients of the award will be contacted by legal counsel for the town to arrange the sign of a purchase and sale. We'd like to do that within 30 days, and our expectation is that we will close on these transfers of property no later than June 30th.
Well, the idea is we want to put the money into our free cash.
In this fiscal year, yeah.
This fiscal year, so
yeah.
We will do everything we can to expedite the process.
One comment I will make is that I did receive feedback from at least one bid respondent saying that the published values for these lots were extraordinarily high and actually disproportionate to other established assessments. We used the assessments that came from the assessor's office, and in some cases the value for the land was extremely high, very, very, very high, and it didn't make sense. Comparison, for example, of one of the two lots on Upper Road, I'll pick that out, had a value per acre of about $30,000, and yet a random lot off of Conway Road, about 6 acres, has an overall value of $36,000 for 6 acres all told. So the assessed value of $30,000 per acre versus a $36,000 for 6 acres, it didn't make sense. And in both cases, they were buildable lots, and in both cases, they were lots that did not have town utilities, for example, just electric available at the street. So it didn't.
Isn't that a Patriots kind of issue?
It's an issue that we hire them to. It'll have to be taken up by the assessors. In all cases, in all of these awards, the town will need to publish in the Central Register, basically notice that all of these pieces of property are being transferred for less than their assessed value. And we'll have to put in a reason as to why we're doing that.
I feel like that assessors need to sort that out with Patriots.
Sorted out with the assessors and the Patriots. We put it up for free bid processes. Whether or not they get it straightened out with the assessment and the assessment office is their business. It's really not ours to chase it. Theirs is in their domain. So, and there may be a very good reason for it, but it is, I don't want to use the canned statement, it is what it is, but that's what it is. So we'll move on from there.
Right.
So.
Can I just talk about mosquitoes for 2 minutes?
No. No. Not even a little bit.
Are we done with that?
That is done. Okay. It's been approved. We both said yes. Nod your head yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
We're going to move into selectmen's comments, and Carolyn can say whatever she wants about mosquitoes.
Okay. This is something that really does work. It's very, it's just like washing your hands in the cold and flu season, in which you should have habits all year round. It's very simple. Doesn't cost much. When you have a liter bottle, you cut it in half. So it's like two parts. Then you can put it together and just put a piece of duct tape around it. And if you have a loose sock or something, they like dark. Mosquitoes like dark. So you can put a sock over it because, you know, I don't sew or anything. Some people sew fancy things. But you can just do it, put it together like this. But before you put it together, what you do is you mix one cup of warm water with a quarter cup of brown sugar and put it into the bottom here. Then you just take a quarter teaspoon of yeast. You can get, you know, baking yeast like you when you bake bread, and you put it in there. Then you put your top on, put a piece of duct tape so it sticks together, and you put these all around your yard, the perimeter of your yard, and the yeast, brown sugar, puts off carbon dioxide, and it attracts the mosquitoes, and it will take the mosquitoes out of your yard. And this really works. I did this last year. You know, somebody randomly sent this information to me, and I said, oh, you know, this sounds really good. So honestly, I tried it, and my yard was mosquito-free. All, you know, you got to have like 4 or 5 of these in your yard. Don't put it by where you sit, obviously. You put it away from where you sit, and you collect your mosquitoes. And you can just, you know, every couple of weeks when it gets full, you just, you know, you can just toss it out and make new ones. But it is really simple, and Pat is going to put this on. I'll have Pat put this on our website. But we've got to do stuff with mosquitoes. And this is how, this is non-toxic. I mean, it's just yeast and brown sugar. It's very simple. You can make kids do it, you know, with you, and it's a, you know, fun little science project. Okay, so that's the mosquito issues. We are moving forward with more information about mosquitoes. We just had a Mohawk Area Public Health meeting on Monday, and we're sorting things out as much as we can. and trying to move forward together as a group of towns from West Springfield up to Greenfield. And, you know, hopefully our warrant article will pass. People are starting to trap mosquitoes and get them tested at the UMass lab, and so we'll know what's circulating in town. The other thing is the you use DEET. Any kind of DEET will keep the mosquitoes away. You need DEET for mosquitoes. DEET does not work on ticks.
And
please don't spill that.
The cheapest thing you can do is you can buy it at Tractor Supply or Greenfield Farmer Supply. It's just Bronco. It's a horse spray. But what you want is a permethrin. P-E-R-M-E-T-H-R-I-N. That is like toxic to, ticks. And you can spray your shoes, like my muck boots, I just keep spraying, and it builds up over time, and the ticks won't even come near you when you walk out in the woods. But just spray your pant legs, obviously on your clothes. But it is pretty safe for animals, so you can, do your horses and dogs and stuff like that, cats if they go outside. But it's real cheap. This bottle is like $7, and it lasts the entire season. So remember that DEET does not work on ticks. You have to have this kind of thing for ticks. But spray DEET if you go out in the evening or the early morning, and try to, police your yards for any water. I mean, it's just a cap full. This bottle cap full of water is enough to breed mosquitoes. So check your pots that have saucers underneath to collect water. Animal, your horse trough, water troughs and stuff like that. The animals need fresh water anyway. So just every other day, give them at least fresh water if you don't do it daily. Dog dishes, any kind of animal thing. Make sure you're circulating and changing the water at least every other day. And make sure that you police your yard after every rainstorm because it takes very little water. But if you use this to collect the mosquitoes and you spray this, you should be okay. And we are really going to monitor stuff. So once we get testing here in town and we know if something's circulating, we'll be sure to let you know. Okay? That's it.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, I mean, it really does
Anything
work.
Else?
No, it does work. Okay.
I believe.
I know everyone gives me a hard time, but keep washing your hands. Yes, I'm going to give it to Doug right now.
I've already got it. For the mix, I've already got it.
Oh, okay.
Yep. Feeds 5 to 7 million, something like that. Saying you're talking about adding sugar and yeast, and I'm thinking, isn't that a recipe for
a good beer?
A good beer, yeah.
Really
right.
Good beer.
Yeah.
Well, it's homemade carbon dioxide, and that's what brings it in.
Oh, is that it? Okay, that's the expectation. All right.
Pretty good. All right.
Oh, no, there's one more thing.
Shoot.
I'm sorry.
I was so focused. No, that's
I've
it.
I've gone
you,
on
you
with
said
my
no.
life.
That's it.
I
Save
know.
It for next week. Nope, that's it.
I've moved on already to, mosquitoes. Go back to the focusing on mosquitoes. I just, about an hour before our meeting, I was driving down my driveway, and I got flagged down by Becky and Tom Clark and Ben and Lori Clark, and they're to come in and celebrate champagne. So, of course, I had to see what was going on. But what it was is Kinder Morgan has announced they have suspended the Northeast Energy Direct pipeline. I don't know if it's permanent or not, but it is temporarily suspended at least. What they said was that they did not have sufficient volume or reasonable expectation of securing them to proceed with the project as currently configured. So I have to say intervention by Montague probably has paid off, and there was not enough contracts, so local contracts. So I have to say I'm absolutely thrilled. So I had already moved on, so... That's how excited I was. Okay.
Let me give you another
second. My son Andrew called from London, who said he had heard it on the news, and He was so happy because he did not have to lend out his apartment in Washington, D.C. for people camping out to go to court in D.C. So he is really relieved that all the people that I had lended out his apartment to so they could go to the Supreme Court and present papers. He does not have to worry about cleaning his apartment and having company. So he was relieved.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Very good. Public comments.
You have two things of note in your binder.
Yep. It's under the tag right there.
Oh.
Put that tab right there. First thing is we had a informational meeting here dealing with the budgets and the annual town meeting articles, and part of it Jeff Upton had put together a barrage of questions and comments during the evolution. He has submitted a 14-point letter of concerns and questions he has, and they're all extremely well written. Most of them are premature, as with a lot of the other issues that go along with this wastewater treatment facility. We're at the beginning of a very long journey, and to answer most of them, we do have a master plan. So that takes the second one off, but basically we're going to address these as we go through the process of trying to update the wastewater treatment facility. And as I said, these are great questions to get the ball rolling with our new committee. Right after the annual town meeting, we'll start working on it. The comments and questions are here. I'm not going to read through them. We covered most of them during the hearing, but he has formalized it and will probably charge the committee that we meet with addressing these in a more formal manner.
Have we, Doug, did you get a list of all the people who are interested?
I did.
Okay, perfect. And we'll call a meeting after, you know, sometime in, you know, probably May or June.
Not this week, please.
No, after.
Yeah, no, we understand that. So sometime late May, June, yeah. Be fine.
Yeah. Start and meeting and sort this out.
What we're talking about is starting a committee to look at the sewer status in the town.
And all these related issues. I actually really appreciate you writing these down so that we have a basis of to address, because you know, this is the kind of stuff that people had raised questions. I mean, not just you, Jeff, a lot of people. And so by you writing them out, we have a really good format to start you know, answering questions and looking, investigating things. I can tell you
there are concerns that I was trying to address all residents, not just non-users or users. You know, everybody's got a stake in this.
And I just want you to know, I really appreciate it, because that's exactly how we have to approach this. We have to approach this in a broad-based agenda, and we have to figure out what we're going to do. And I think all of us were really shocked. I mean, when I submitted that hypothetical $20 million to HUD for that grant, I thought I was shooting huge numbers. I said, you know, this is going to handle it, right? And so I have to say, I was absolutely, absolutely shocked when I was hearing 30, 32 million. I'm saying, I hadn't even imagined that as, you know, a pie in the sky number. So I think we were all taken aback and we were all shocked, and we've got to sort this out. I mean, this is a huge, long-term, many, many years overhaul. And we got to sort out funding sources. I mean, that one HUD grant was just a one-shot deal. But
it's sufficient to say there's a lot of work that needs to be done.
Yeah.
And it's also, I want to make sure people understand that are watching this, that nothing's cast in stone. There are no brainchilds in this aspect. We would like everybody who has questions or concerns about the sewer treatment facilities in the town of Deerfield to
to feel free to come forward with any of their questions or comments on either side, whether resident or non-resident, because we need to address them. We're not going to move forward until we actually have a full understanding amongst the townspeople to have support. Without the support, we're not going to get anywhere. But understand that it's not going to be years, because we have some problems that we need to address, and part of them are going to be addressed through this annual town meeting. And we need to start pinging these off sooner than later. So I don't want people thinking that they can sit back and wait for years and years, because it's something that is going to raise its awareness, whether we like it or not.
One of the things that is addressing some of your issues was alternative technologies might be available too down the road, and that is a huge consideration for us, and it might be worth investing in alternative energies, and if we technologies, I mean, and if that's what we do, we might make us more eligible for different kinds of grants. And you know, we just have to get a more of a handle on the grant, what's out there as far as who's lending money, because there are many, many, many sewer systems that across the country, infrastructure-wise, that need updating, and as part of the resilient communities kind of thing with climate change. And so we have to play that card very heavily, because ours is right next to Connecticut River, and so potentially there's more opportunities for us sooner than later. And I just heard of one Long Island Sound initiative that came out, I mean, because they're worried about the pollution going into Long Island Sound and the oyster beds being affected. So there was new money coming out, and I was like, oh, that means we're eligible, because, you know, the Connecticut River feeds down there. So there's other opportunities that we hadn't even thought about yet, you know.
Well, I think I speak for a lot of people in town that thank you for addressing concerns and willing to move forward with the committee to review this and that. That does leave me with one last question, though, not to light a fire or anything, but Article 6 on the special town meeting, are you planning to withdraw that or pass, or?
We're going to surprise you.
Okay.
Can you let me in on
that? That was a good surprise.
Okay.
Whatever it is, because we haven't discussed it, it will be a surprise.
Clearly I don't know too much about that yet. So I guess it will be a surprise.
Doug will get with you.
Okay.
I get no comfort from that. I'm concerned, obviously I'm concerned about Article 6. And I just think it's premature. No problem with non-sewer users paying a fair share, but Six is
it
written?
We have heard and thoroughly understand the concerns that you have, and we're waiting. We have heard at the meeting the concerns that you had, and I think we've gone over them. And if you have something else you'd like to add to our deliberation on this, we don't have an answer for you. So I don't know how to give you more comfort in the fact that we could withdraw it or we could go forward with it. We haven't been able to have a meeting to address it, so whatever it is we're going to give you will have to come from the deliberation of us, and we don't have an answer. So,
well, the
you said surprise. To me, it sounded like you reached a conclusion.
No.
We can't. I mean, that's one of the hardest parts. That's one of the hardest things about the open meeting law is that we're not even allowed to just have a conversation about.
Okay.
Well, what do you think? You know, so we got to have.
We have a discussion with.
We
Doug,
do it
and
here.
Doug has to have a discussion with the other one, and then we come to consensus between.
And I haven't heard anything from Doug on this, so.
Okay. So if you notice, Section 8 of your agenda, Items I and J are final reviews of the FY17 budget and the motions for annual and special
okay.
town meeting.
So that's when Doug is supposed to tell me that.
You'll both get copies, and
okay.
I want to walk through this.
All right.
I need direction on what it is you'd like to do. So, yeah, we have to talk about these.
We're just tonight. Assuring you that we have not violated the open meeting law because we don't discuss this stuff. So
if you stick around till we get to that article
that part of this agenda, then the surprise will be go away. But if you really want a surprise, you should go home and not listen to the tape. And okay.
My wife.
Take for the home movie. Yeah.
Okay. The other announcement is a small town summit. Actually, that looks like really a good thing to go to. Doug, were you planning on going to?
I will actually. May 5th. Is that a Thursday?
That's a Thursday. Yeah.
If it's a Thursday, then I would be able to attend.
Yeah, it is a Thursday.
Okay. Yeah. I'd like to attend that. And any opportunity that I can to meet with other representatives from towns in Franklin County in particular, but anywhere within the Hilltowns, I want to try to take advantage of that. I found that creating those relationships have been extremely beneficial to me, so this is one thing I'd like to
attend. Can you circulate this to all the town boards?
The Small Town Summit?
Yes.
It has been circulated.
Okay.
Deerfield Town Boards, I'm sorry. I will. Yes.
In case the Finance Committee or anybody else wants to go.
Or send you with...
Fair enough.
Oh, yeah. That's a good idea, too, Mark. If they can't make it, then if there's anything that they want, any issue you want us to bring up, be sure to let us know. I mean, obviously, one of the biggest things is, you know, increasing school costs. You know, that kind of thing. But whatever. Okay. Let's move on.
Select board comments. You addressed your mosquitoes and the pipeline.
Under board health, yeah.
We hadn't gotten that far yet. But SCEMS, RFP gone out yet or no?
No, it is not.
RFP has not gone out for the housing of the SCEMS, so we have no information on that. South County Senior Center has been moving forward. Have we got a... recipient for the outreach coordinator position?
I can speak very quickly to that. Speaking with Marlene Johnson, she's been accepting applications for the outreach coordinator position. For the last time I talked to her, she had received something like 85 applications, and they were still coming in. As a matter of fact, one came in today. The deadline is tomorrow. She will be doing a cursory first review, and then we'll be selecting somewhere between 5 and 8 applicants to interview. She'll be looking for assistance with that. It's likely that Mark Prohensky and myself may be asked to sit in on those interviews, those first interviews, and then likely one or two final candidates, maybe three, will go before the South County Board of Oversight, the South County Senior Center Board of Oversight, for final interview and selection. So she's stunned by the amount of response she's gotten, and she's definitely working her way through that.
Very good. Tilton Library, I haven't made a meeting since the last meeting, so I have nothing to update on. I have talked, and it looks like we're in pretty good shape at this point with their meetings and schedule for public information about the new needs assessment at the library. Anything else, Doug? I'm missing?
Not for those reports. Not that I have.
The Historical Commission was talking about doing a breakout for the village area for doing make presentation of the town of Deerfield in the town square and the village area for improvements. Have they broached getting a committee to actually look into that?
No, not yet, but I would be very interested in working with them on that.
Yeah, I was very interested to hear it, so I think that by making us, you know, people out there understand that we're looking for people to work on a committee that would look at a better presentation of the town or the village of South Deerfield. And not to be exclusive just to that, but having a some programs where we can actually have people get involved and enjoy helping the town look better and present better.
I think I might know someone might be interested in a participant. We should.
Oh, wonderful.
Our office would be a good start, and we'll pass it on to the historical.
Please do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful.
It's all, and at the end of the day, it's going to have to be charged from our department anyways, from our office anyways. So it's a good place to start. And if we can get enough people that are willing to give this can a kick, we'll get it out sooner than later. You know, and some of the things we talked about were sometimes they have, you know, adopt a fire hydrant, and, you know, a street pole or something like that to just, you can put a couple hours a month into, which helps the town look good. And the others are subcommittees that look at, you know, what we're going to do with the common, what can we do to help people that are on the main street to be more in tune with what selling things or bring more commerce to the local area. Any of those ideas that we come, we want to see if we can get them to flourish, because I think the town will benefit by people's involvement. So I was very excited to hear him start the conversation, but and we hope that people will follow through with it.
I went to the Regional Emergency Planning Committee meeting on yesterday, and mass casualty incident, a drill that was at the East Deerfield rail yard, went really, really well. And so they're going to plan a next phase coming up this summer. It is going to be an event. It's joint with Hampshire Regional Emergency Planning Council, and it's going to be down at Hatfield near CNS, and it's going to involve passenger train and hazardous materials spill or something. And so we're hoping to participate again. It was really well done, and I want to thank all our first responders for participating. The Franklin Regional Sheltering Project has also been moving ahead. We have an informal agreement with Greenfield and Montague, and because they have more paid staff, they are the primary sheltering, opening a shelter in an event, and we're a backup at Frontier. And but we're going to have a tabletop sometime this summer, because people, it is quite complicated to open a shelter. People don't have any idea how many moving parts it takes. And, you know, people have animals, they have service animals, and they have their regular pets and all kinds of issues. So what we're going to do is do a tabletop to practice doing that. And so I'm happy to say we'll be doing it in the next few months, sometime over the summer. And that's extremely important. So that project is moving ahead. And then Doug is going to take up the multi-agency coordination center agreement in his administrative report. But we are, as the town of Deerfield is participating, and I have to say that I'm very proud of our police department, our EMS, and our fire departments for participating in all these events. And it really is critical for us to be prepared. So the participation rate has been greatly improved over the last 5 years. I think you've noticed that, Mark.
Absolutely.
So it's just, I want to thank people, because of course everybody's doing it as a volunteer, and it does take up a lot of time, but it is really wonderful that our people in our community care. So, and they are working. Okay, that's all I have to say for comments.
I'm just giving you a second.
I'm sorry.
I want to cut you off.
I know. It probably was that
covered
glass
the,
of champagne I had earlier.
We already covered Board of Health issues?
Yes. The mosquitoes have been issued a warning.
Going once, going twice. Okay. We have a one-day liquor license for Red Roof Inn.
Correct. This is for a grand reopening that they're planning. And it is for April It's actually coming up very, very quickly. It's April 27.
Yep.
To expire the same day, of course. So there's
actually,
that.
Doug, doesn't it have to be issued the day before and the day after?
That's my understanding as well, and so we may need to make changes to the way this permit is written. Generally speaking, yes, a day before to load in and set up, and a day after for cleanup and complete breakdown.
Right.
But it'll be basically an open house on April 27 between 5 and 7 p.m. offering appetizers. The event will be catered by Monarch's Restaurant, and members of the Franklin County Chamber of Commerce will be in attendance, will be invited.
So, okay. I make a motion we approve this as presented.
Second that. For conversation, can't we just approve it for the day before and day after for setup and breakdown?
Yeah, actually, let's do that, Doug, because that's traditionally how we do it, and
sure,
then they
absolutely
don't have to come back.
Yep.
I'm sure this is not a big deal, but we'll just issue it to them so that in case that turns out to be the case, they don't have to come back.
Right, and if you authorize the use of the signature stamps, we can get this out first thing in the morning.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Second that?
Yep. Mark, you're right. We need to just do it and not worry about it.
Next thing we have is a liquor license for Franklin Land Trust.
Correct. This is an event that happens every year. It's the Franklin County Land Trust Randonnée. It will be happening on August 19. Actually, I think it's actually two separate events, August 19 and August 20th. They're actually asking for two separate licenses to cover the 2 days. And so there we are. Generally speaking, in the past, the board has not only issued this, but also waived the fee for it, as Frank County Land Trust is a local charitable organization that the board has opted to support. You can choose to do that or not. And the board has also, in the past, made this license award subject to approval and coordination with the Deerfield Police Department, to be sure that the event is a safe one as well.
I make a motion that we approve this with the waiver, subject to coordination with the police department. I know we've done it in the past, but and there's been no issues, but it would be nice just to say that, you know, the chief has input on this. Okay.
Second. And I guess we should put the same stipulation for day before setup and breakdown.
Yeah, Doug, just make sure that on the application that there's a sig. I don't think they need it, but just in case, okay?
Yep, absolutely. I'll be sure that that is the case.
Favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Very good. I don't know if in your packet you have a copy. I'm sorry, Evan, and I cut you off, I think. I was going to say, I don't know if you have a draft of the school resource officer MOU in your packet.
I did review it. The chief had sent it to me on the email.
Yeah, there's copies right here.
Oh,
This is an MOU that was negotiated by the chief with the superintendent of schools. He actually has, the superintendent has signed a copy, but in conversation with the chief, he and I both agreed that this needs to come before the board for authorization. And you can either choose to sign it directly or give the chief the authorization to sign on behalf of the town in this one case.
How do you want to proceed on this, Mark? I don't have a problem if you want the chief to sign.
The problem I have is that this is in the budget and we're authorizing expenditures that need to be voted at annual town meeting, and there's no...
I think we can vote this subject to town meeting, success at town meeting.
Problem having the chief sign it would be successful, because this document says we're on the hook for the upcoming year, which I agree with. I support that. I formally support having the resource officer. I think it's a great endeavor. It's worked very well for us. This is dealing with a resource officer. I apologize that I sat back and probably nobody heard me. The issue I have is the fact that this MOU commits the town to funds being expended in the next calendar year, and that is funding that is part of the annual, should be part of the annual town meeting. I basically fully support this. As I've said in the past, I think that it should be a partnership between the schools, the towns, and the commerce, and anybody else who wants to see our kids be safe in their arena. So I have no problem with authorizing the signature of this by the chief.
Would you like him to wait until after town meeting?
I was just going to say, make it subject to success at town meeting.
Floor. So sure. I have no problem with that.
Okay.
Why don't we take a formal vote on that then, so that we have that subject to success at the town meeting for that.
That's what we just did.
Yeah. No, but I mean, I think we need to vote on it.
Yeah.
Okay.
No problem with that. All in favor of supporting the school resource letter, memorandum of understanding, and have the chief sign it after successfully being funded at annual town meeting.
Aye.
Great. Thank you.
Next thing is we're at the SCEMS IMA review and approval.
I don't know if you have this in your packet or not. I thought you might, but you may not. There's two copies there. The intermunicipal agreement, as you know, governs the arrangement between the towns of Whately, Sunderland, and Deerfield for the operation of the South County EMS service, the Emergency Medical Service. Through our reexamination of the document with the director of the service, there were a number of changes that we're recommending. Many of them, I would say most of them, are procedural. Most of them are cleaning up language. Instead of consistently referring to the town of Deerfield when it comes to appointing employees, paying bills, reviewing the budget, so on and so forth, the recommended changes are to change that to the fiscal agent, and to define the fiscal agent farther up in the top of the document. That cleans up the language in case another town chooses to become the fiscal agent later on, for example. Then you change the document only once. There are a few other things in here that I believe the Board of Oversight has already looked at and examined. For example, the change of the fiscal agent, the fiscal representative on the Board of Oversight to be a voting member, whereas currently that person is not a voting member.
So the having the fiscal agent be a voting member was recommended by the Oversight Committee?
I believe so.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, it was.
All right. Okay.
The most... I know it's going to cause the biggest heartache and contention is in Article 4, Budgeting and Finance, Section 1, okay. Fiscal Agent, Part B, Annual Budget, Subpart A, Preparation, Subpart 4, Operating Budget.
Okay, so Article 4...
Yeah, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. It's about towards the bottom of the fourth page of text.
Okay.
So 1, 2, 3, 4. And it's Roman numeral 4, and then it continues to Roman numeral 5.
Okay.
I actually mentioned all of those headers intentionally, because the section of the agreement deals with budgeting and finance, related to the annual budget, related to the operating budget, and then to the capital budget, and the preparation of same. Because this is the only part of the agreement that says anything about a geographic location. And the geographic locations that are mentioned are the South Deerfield Fire Department, the Sunderland Fire Department, and I believe the Whately Fire Department. And they're only mentioned as defining those spaces as being the responsibility of the respective towns to maintain, and that the EMS shall not be required to maintain, for example, the roof or the outer shell of the building or any space within the building not being utilized by the EMS.
So what is being replaced?
What is being recommended? Let's take a look at number 4, for example.
Okay.
So I'll read it out for everybody who's watching and listening. Operating budget. Those budget lines included within the total budget which pertain to the operation of South County EMS and the operation and maintenance of the physical space utilized by South County EMS, as stated in, replace the word the with any, and add applicable building lease agreement.
Period.
The highlighted text, I know it's barely, you can barely see it, that talks about the primary building, the reserve building, and the standby building.
Are you deleting?
Correct.
So there's no mention of any place.
It just mentions any applicable building lease agreement.
Okay.
Including but not limited to utilities, rents and leases, heat, custodial services and supplies, related insurance, snow removal, acquisition of fixed assets, and repair of fixed costs. For repair of fixed assets, will be apportioned according to Section 1B sub B of this article. Annual budget apportionment costs.
Okay.
And then it says operating and maintenance costs related to, scratch the primary buildings with any, physical space not utilized by the South County EMS will be the responsibility of the owner of the physical space.
Okay. So all you're doing is eliminating the three locations.
Eliminating the three locations and basically genericizing the text.
Okay. So the Board of Oversight looked at this and they have nobody, I mean, we're not, if we do vote this, they recommend it, right?
Yeah, the Board of Oversight is, you know.
So there's no,
we're
no.
We've gone out for an RFP and with the RFP, if the site.
Why don't you speak in here?
We're going to go out for an RFP for where we're going to reside. Again, the Board of Oversight sees the need for the ambulance service to be in a single location for operability. And we had picked the locations based upon almost 2-year review process, which created a lot of anxiety mostly in the town of Deerfield. Put people at ease to understand that we're not looking to jump ship or move someplace or create hate and discontent. The Board of Oversight looked into the possibility of going out for an RFP for location so that we could put our ambulances in one spot, which would give us a lot better service than we're able to perform right now, which I have to say is phenomenal in its own right, but is getting better as we speak. So to do that, to have that RFP work, we have to go where the review of the documents take us. And to spell out we're in certain locations and thinking of changing, it requires us to go to annual town meeting to address that and explain it. And
explain these changes. And I think that the Board of Oversight felt that it was very necessary for us to have that flexibility to make the ambulance as good as it can be. So that's where that one came from.
Okay.
But can we go back to
of course.
The wording going from fiscal, from the town of Deerfield to fiscal agent?
Sure. Where are you?
Did you guys get a copy of this? Doug, is there enough copies?
I don't have multiple copies. I can get.
How about you? You guys want to share this, and then Mark and I can share it.
On the second page at the bottom.
I can't really see the highlight, but this is what we're talking about.
Ambulance director. Subsection C. Remove elected.
You can see it's a little bit highlighted.
Maybe removed by the fiscal agent, which shall first hold in here. And the fiscal agent, again, anywhere where it says Deerfield or the town of Deerfield, the expectation is to replace that with the defined term of the fiscal agent to be defined separately separately from the fiscal representative.
So where do you spell out where is the fiscal agent? What's the definition?
Okay.
Where is that?
That's a really good question.
There's somewhere in there that we should explain that, you know, we're used to having the town of Deerfield appoint a fiscal agent, which
correct.
Is a misnomer. We are the fiscal agent because we bid that process in our and won it as part of the IMA. But the reality of it is, we have a representative from the town of Deerfield that represents the fiscal side.
Right.
The other members represent the town both at large and for EMS needs and understanding. So somewhere in here it should explain that when we say fiscal agent, it means the town in which is fiscally responsible for the ambulance service.
Correct.
It could be that at some point in town, the town of the ambulance service could go out and hire somebody to do the mundane paperwork or the paperwork that keeps us running if it happened to be a hospital or somebody who had those functions, and they would be the fiscal agent and they would have the HR needs to support the ambulance service to continue to be fully functional and in good standings. I don't see that ever happening, but this generic statement takes it down to the point where whoever we appoint, and what happens is the three towns have to appoint them. It has to go back to vote as to both in how we fiscally support that agency. In other words, they pay the town of Deerfield money for the service, and it would have to be part of that budget to change from one to the other. So it's just making it generic so that every time we change the way we do business to be better, we don't have to come back and ask for forgiveness in the wording. Is that pretty accurate?
It is accurate. I'd also like to point out that in Article 4, which is at the bottom of the third page of text, the fiscal agent is defined. It says the town of Deerfield shall serve as a fiscal agent for South County EMS and shall have control of and be responsible for receipts and disbursements and down the line. Go up a page to Article 2, Governance, Board of Oversight Composition. It says the Board of Selectmen of each member town will appoint two individuals to serve on the Board of Oversight. In addition, the fiscal agent identified in this agreement, and that refers to the town of Deerfield, shall appoint one designee to serve on the Board of Oversight as a non-voting member. And again, we're making the recommendation that that be a third voting member for the town of Deerfield.
And again, that was voted by the Board of Oversight, and they feel strongly that that would give a more power to the fiscal strength of the organization. I'm very neutral on the subject. I don't. It was voted unanimously. Anonymously. It was voted full with a full complement of the board.
Exactly.
Before I got a chance to vote, so I stay with the board. I'm very happy. I think that their makeup is extremely well and working. Of all the committees that I sit on and have sat on, this seems to be the most dedicated and charged to a successful outcome of the organization. So I can't speak any more highly of any organization I've worked with. So,
Doug, do you want us to vote on this tonight, or?
I'm happy to continue exploring the document as you need to. I would like to point out, counting pages here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Where is it? I apologize. On page 6, Article 5, General Contract Conditions, number 2, Amendments. The provision that stays in place is substantial changes, the last sentence of this part, substantial changes to the agreement, such as a change in location or the addition of a member town, shall require town meeting approval in each then existing member town. The first comment I have is that one thing that was never done was to define what location means. There's a general assumption, but any lawyer will tell you that general assumptions get you into a whirlwind of trouble. Nowhere in here does it say that the EMS shall operate out of a specific location or that the EMS shall be based at a specific location. And that should be defined. Or it should be somehow encoded in the agreement, particularly if it requires town meeting approval to change that.
So since that's not highlighted, that means that that's not one of the recommendations.
That will not change, right.
That recommendation will not change. Okay.
Correct.
I mean, there is no recommendation. Okay.
Correct. So the
excuse me.
But going into this RFP, we may need to change the physical space where the ambulance service is located and operates out of. And in order to do that, we need to get town meeting.
If Sunderland and Whately had to move their ambulances to Deerfield, then we would have to maybe do that?
Correct. Okay. I would think that if we decide to, let's say Deerfield, South Deerfield Fire District said, oh, go ahead and use the whole bay, we don't mind, and the EMS wanted to move all three ambulances there, I think that would still require a vote by all three member towns to approve that.
Okay.
Because currently the ambulances are stationed in their respective towns. That language isn't changing, and nobody's recommending that it change because it does offer protections to the towns as well as the EMS.
Why don't we wait to discuss that can of worms once we get the RFPs back and decide what's going on? Since that isn't even on the table to be discussed, let's please not talk about it at the moment.
Okay.
I think it's important that it's pointing out the fact that we're not changing that.
Yes.
In this revision.
I know, and that's why I didn't want to address it.
Of the IMA is what.
I'm okay with the other changes, and since it's a recommendation of the Oversight Board, I make the motion that we approve the changes.
I'll second that.
Okay.
Any further discussion?
No. I don't have any more questions. I think that solves a lot of issues.
So I want to clarify, make sure this is very absolutely
crystal clear. We're only approving what is highlighted.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
But his question has something else to do.
My question has to do with the motion from town meeting. And forgive me for needing to take a moment to look it up.
When we pass over it?
I believe it's Article
25. Not a passover. We would vote to no action because we're not discussing the motion.
I want to hear what he has to say.
Sorry, give me a minute to look it up. So Article 25 states to see if the town will vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to act in the best interest of the town to negotiate in order to make changes to the EMS intermunicipal agreement or take any action relative thereto. As it's written, this is asking for permission that you already enjoy. Being an intermunicipal agreement, you have the authority to make changes in accordance with the other two boards of selectmen in the other two towns, except for the fact that in this contract, a change in location is the one thing, well, one of two things, that you can't do independent of town meeting. So my question is it your intention to not make a change in location
at this time
until after the RFP is concluded, and to not request town meeting grant permission for a change in location until after the RFP is concluded? Okay.
Because we don't know what the RFP is going to say, or at least in my mind, I don't know who's going to respond to the RFP and what the decision related to the RFP is. So why?
Okay.
Why would we vote?
It just means that in order to let, if the RFP is issued tomorrow or Monday and it goes for a month and we get the responses and in 5 or 6 weeks we say, yes, that's it, that's where we're going, we will then have to hold a special town meeting in order to authorize that change.
But I think it's a significant discussion item that a special town meeting by itself for that sole subject is worth it.
Okay. Then I would recommend that at the annual town meeting, you vote to take note.
We've had special town meetings and we've been railroaded because it just
enough people show up.
It takes a handful of people to derail what 1,000 people may be thinking, because all they have to do is come in and be disagreeable to the thought process. So, I would probably, recommend that we. We're in for a fight no matter what we do.
I think it's premature, so I hate to discuss it.
Then I will recommend that you request the town moderator not take up Article 25 at all. And we can inform.
I think that, that's something that, who's the proposer of the article?
You are. It's your town meeting.
But is the Board of Oversight going to speak to it because it's their MO?
No. It would have to be the Board of Selectmen asking for permission to make that change, to allow you to make changes to the IMA, which include changes in location. If the changes to the IMA that you want to make do not include a change in location or the addition of a member town, then you don't need town meeting approval to make the changes.
So we can approve what we just approved.
You just did,
and
right?
That becomes the IMA.
And so long as the other two towns approve it, we can clean up the language, tighten down the agreement, and get a clean copy for you to sign.
And the fiscal agent becomes, so as effective of our vote, the fiscal agent is a voting member now?
So long as the other two towns also concur, then yes, whomever you appoint as that third person, whether it be a financial advisor to the Board of Oversight or what have you, that person would have a vote on the Board of Oversight.
Okay.
Yeah, great.
While we're on the subject of the ambulance, at the Homeland Security meeting on Tuesday, I talked to Linda Moriarty, and she's in charge of Western Mass EMS. It does all our continuing ed credits for our EMTs and does training and all that kind of stuff. Their budget was still $100,000 short. Steve Kulik is on top of that and is trying to put in, is in support of the additional $100,000. But I can't remember the legislator that she said now. I'm blanking out. But it's Amendment 531. We need to send a letter of support to Stan Rosenberg, Steve Kulik, and the governor. I guess it would be addressed to the governor. And, Steve Kulik, Stan Rosenberg, saying the word support of 531. Which is adds in the additional $100,000 to Western Mass EMS. And Linda can fill you in on, it's similar to the letter we sent last year, Doug. Casey should have it on, it should be on the computer. But Linda can fill you in if you have any issues, or Zach can give you the information, because Zach would have it, I'm sure.
Amendment 531?
I think it's Amendment 531.
And Kulik is sponsoring it?
No, it's not sponsored by Kulik. It's not Pignelli. What's the other?
Mark?
Mark signed on it just like Steve Kulik, but he did not he was not the initiator.
Okay.
It's one of the other Berkshire ones. Do you remember who it is? Okay. Well, Linda can fill you in. But I just wanted to make sure we voted to send a letter. Correct. I make a motion that we send a letter.
Second.
Okay.
All in favor? Oh, any further comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Because that $100,000 is a very significant part of their budget to help us maintain our, especially our volunteer, the part-timers. But it's also our continuing ed course for our full-timers, too, and the certifications and training. They organize all the training and all that kind of stuff. So it's has huge impact on us as a community, or South County EMS, but all of Western Mass, because the services on the eastern part of the state have somebody on staff to do this. Western Mass is for us. This one little office does it for everybody in Western Mass. Okay.
Sounds good.
I want to go back to Article 25.
Do you want a copy of the warrant?
Yeah, since you didn't hand them out, it'd be nice. I have the special, but I'll have this. We can share this.
Okay. The motion, as is printed in that version that you have, is totally draft and definitely not something that I would do right now.
What I'd like to do is keep that in play, so that at least, if nothing else, we have good conversation as to whether or not we have the understanding of the townspeople of what's going on.
Okay.
And we can pull it and withdraw the motion anytime we want. But I think it's important for people to understand that this is vitally important to providing services.
Maybe what you can do, Doug, is have a more definitive time schedule for the RFP. Get that information.
Okay.
So people would know if, are we talking about having a special town meeting within 6 weeks or 8 weeks or 6 months, whatever. Because we normally have a special town meeting in the fall, so it's not, to me, it's not a big deal.
Certainly.
But I think this is premature in the sense that we don't have a return on the RFPs.
Sure. The intention behind the article, though, was to simply authorize the board to negotiate changes. It basically allows you to start having the conversation.
It's not voting to do anything. It's just voting to authorize the board to do what is legally available to us. We just wrote a article, or we wrote a IMA that was restrictive at the time, which was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, to say we're going to have it this way, and this is the way it's going to be until we re-vote it. Now, at this point in time, I think the ambulance service has come to us as a entity and said, listen.
I guess I just don't feel comfortable at this point, Mark.
Okay.
The language, from what I understand, because, again, this is an article on the town meetings for both Whately and Sunderland as well.
Correct.
The article language is identical on the Whately and Sunderland town warrants. The motion language that is being will likely be recommended in Whately is actually better than what I've got drafted here. And essentially, the motion in Whately will read, I'm wordsmithing here, that the town authorizes the Whately Board of Selectmen to act in the best interests of the town to negotiate in order to make changes to the South County Emergency Management Services Intermunicipal Agreement
Said changes may include a change in location or the addition of a member town. And that's language right out of that Article 5, Section 2 amendments portion of the IMA. So basically it goes right to that.
To the MMA. The IMA.
It allows it based, and it's the authorization that the IMA requires, that the board have authorization from the town to make a change to a location. So, again, I will go with whatever you'd like to do.
I think it's time for us to hear what the town has to say, and I mean, it's the subject that's going to have to be. It's the 900-pound elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about, and it's vital to the organization, which is our ambulance service, which gives us the service that I hope everybody's proud of. And if this is something that the town feels strongly that they're willing to expend the money to have a full-time ambulance service within its town, then that's the way we should go. I mean, it's the townspeople's right to have the information, and I think that the annual town meeting is the way it should go, and I don't think that it's fair to have a service that has already proven beyond a shadow of a doubt having ambulances in three towns is detrimental to the services provided to the people it serves. You're asking for us to put on hold something that we already know is detrimental to the people that the ambulance service services. It increases the wait time for the second ambulance if it is called upon for someone to go get an ambulance that's between 8 and 10 miles away. That just adds between 5 to 10 minutes.
All right, let's talk about it. That's fine.
I think it's valuable for the conversation to be had.
Right.
I don't think that we may or may not solve it, but at least have the conversation.
All right, I'm okay with that then. All right, that's fine.
Fair enough.
It's fine. We'll just leave
it. Just leave it, and we'll. And that still gives us the option to take no action.
Yeah.
Based upon the way the conversation goes.
That's fine.
Okay.
Are we going to do the rest of this document, or where are we going to jump to now?
Do you want to stay in order? I think we were on Section 8, Part E, town-owned parcels for sale.
Which we went.
Covered that.
No, this is actually something different.
Oh, okay.
I was going to sort of roll it into the same item.
You guys don't need to stay on meeting. I mean, we love you to stay. Yes. No, actually, it's wonderful because we don't get a lot of people usually. Jeff has been really good about coming, and of course Trevor has been coming quite a lot lately too.
And
John has been really good about showing up. But I didn't want you to feel that we had anything else. Oh, okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Especially with the smiles. That's something we don't get a lot of in here.
Okay, so Doug,
Another article on the annual town meeting warrant is request for authorization for the Board of Selectmen to dispose of town-owned land. We have something on the order of 30 or 40 properties that the town owns and is not using, and between Board of Assessors, the building commissioner, and myself, we've slowly been looking at that stack of that list of properties. And I have about 6 or 7 properties here I would like to have you both take a look at and give me a read on it if you have any objections to whether or not these properties would be okay to put on the list. These properties will be listed both in terms of a street address as well as a map and a lot on the town meeting in the article and in the handout that's going to be submitted to town meeting members when they come into town meeting. The maps will be posted on a bulletin board at the high school on the night of town meeting so folks can take a look at the properties that we're talking about. These have already, I've run them by Kevin Scarborough to ask him if there was any potential use
for any of these properties as far as the town was concerned. And the only comments he had were that some of the properties up on Pine Nook Road, they're fairly large and mostly wooded, and that he would insist that we ask for a minimum price for those, because any less than X dollars, it would be more worth it for the town to retain them and then to look for timber services to get people to bid on the opportunity to log the lot, and that the town could use that as a source of income while retaining ownership of the property. But he had no conceivable use for the properties.
Are there any of those on Pine Nook contiguous to our town forest?
The town forest?
Yes.
Is there a town forest up there? Okay. I have no information about that.
Right. Well, in that general area, Humpcomter Ridge.
I have no information on that.
Okay.
I think there's one piece of property on Pine Nook that extends from Pine Nook, and it goes up the west side of that ridge, and abuts at least a corner of it abuts the town-owned parcel where our towers are, if that means anything. But there's nothing on top of the ridge in that bowl.
The only thing I'd ask you to do is just get the map of our town forest. Okay. And then just see how these parcels line up to the forest.
Okay.
Because we don't, you know, what you're, for any kind of habitat, we do minimal forest management. We should be doing more. And we attempted before Mr. Crafts died to do some forest management planning. And when he died, we didn't put any more effort into it. But what we can do, I know UMass has some students, forestry students, and we should allow our town forest to be used as a class project or something.
Okay.
And see if we can get a forest plan done by the students, and then we could get it stamped or certified by a forester, certified forester, for far cheaper because the plan is already done.
Okay.
And then we could get someone to implement it. But the main thing is, if any of these parcels are contiguous for the habitat and forest management, we wouldn't want to give them up. But it doesn't, I haven't looked at them, and it doesn't, just looking at what Mark's looking at, I don't, you know, maybe this is not going to be any issue, but just verify it, because contiguous with our forest, we should maintain it. And it could be just random pieces that had come up.
I know that at least one that's up in that area is abutted by private landowner lots, as well as by lots that are owned by the Allen Chase Foundation and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So in at least one case, the town's property is surrounded by other municipal property or other non-municipal properties. So in that case, I'd be willing to bet that it's not part of any kind of larger sort of reserve. In many cases, the properties are located elsewhere in town, and it's property that could potentially be commercially developable.
Okay. I certainly think it's absolutely the good thing to inventory everything that we have, and you know, anything that we can get on the tax rolls is absolutely critical here, but the money that we would receive for contiguous to our forest land would be minimal, and it would be worth holding on to.
Sure.
And if it's a contiguous piece to other, when are you saying that, you know, the state of Massachusetts or the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, that could be one of the forested areas that connects to our forested area.
Okay.
So we just want to make sure that we're not going to interfere with any habitat potential.
Okay.
Or a management of forest kind of stuff.
And you know, we're going to take our time with these to determine a proper value. I think we were very successful in doing a request for proposals instead of a straight bid, in that the town was able to consider the potential use of the property instead of just, oh, who has the highest price.
I was just going to say, I personally feel very, very strongly that best use mm-hmm. is the criteria that we want to use, because it gives us more flexibility.
Sure.
To what is the advantage to the town, and it shouldn't always be dollar amount. Getting them back on the tax roll is more critical in a best use versus the actual purchase price, in my mind, mm-hmm. sometimes.
Thank you, Ernest, for this piece. I think that piece has already been sold to Leader Lumber.
Is that the one on, is it Depot Street? According to the, well, I'll double check with the assessors, but.
I think that was one that we were going to sell them, but then the economy tanked and it actually never went through. But. We had talked about it, so yeah, just check
on,
it.
It was on the books we sold. I mean, as a matter of fact, they're using it as their parking space now.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah,
but I'm pretty sure it's town-owned still.
That may also be a property that would be better served to leave as parking, as public parking, in the long term, and thinking about commercial development in South Deerfield, in this village center, it might be better to leave it as public parking and to dress it up a little bit better.
Yeah.
So.
Can we just verify with the assessors this off Mill Village, this parcel right here? I think this has a blown, this parcel has.
Is it the one right along the river?
Yes, and it has I don't want to say dam, it's a berm that was put there after the 1936 hurricane, and it got blown out by Irene.
That could very well be.
And this is actually critical habitat for salamanders. We're trying to get that rebuilt, that berm rebuilt, because it was it's substantially, I mean, it's like 16 feet below what it was.
Sure.
So anytime that,
sure.
Anything that we have an event, doesn't even have to be extreme event, an event will come and it's going to flood Mill Village through that part.
Okay. That if that's the one that's on,
so
the
I think
end
this
of
is
what,
Williams
Clark's Cross,
and this, yes,
that actually should not be in this pile. That is one that after a discussion with Kevin, we determined that one should not be sold. It has little to any value to anyone. It's too close to the river to be used even for farming, and a good third of that is actually already gone. The river has moved that much, so you can go ahead and pull that one right out. That
okay, but I mean, we are attempting to
great.
Get that back,
sure.
Built back up.
It won't be included, though. Absolutely. That it was.
I still think we should unload it, but we need to fix it first, I guess.
Someone will buy it for $1.98, I think.
I don't know. No, I don't think so, because I'd have to put in $500,000 plus permitting.
Okay. So we will likely, what my expectation is that we'll get the authorization from town meeting, but these will go through a vetting process through the Board of Assessors, and probably, Planning Board? Conservation Commission, perhaps, to see if anyone has any comments about it.
Just run it through everybody.
Yeah. And it's going to come back here before any RFP is going to be issued. So.
Okay. But that's fine.
All right. These will be listed on the town meeting. In part of the motion. Okay. Oh boy.
Peg up access upgrade.
Okay. This is a two. I'll just call this the first of two things. It's ridiculous to hold a giant piece of paper, but it was the only way I could print this out so you could actually read it. So I apologize in advance, but we understand the reasoning. A couple of weeks back, I mentioned to Mark that I had been in communication with HB Communications, which is a state-approved vendor. They're on the state bid list, which allows us to contract with them without public procurement happening, for upgrades to the cameras and the video recording equipment here in Town Hall. The bid that we got at the time was slightly over $70,000, and Mark expressed concern about the cost, so I went back to HB and actually asked them to revise the bid. The date says 3/18, but that's when we first actually contacted them. This bid reduces the work that they would do. Reuses a great deal of equipment, particularly the large cabinets and the vertical upright racks that are actually a pretty expensive component. It reuses some of the monitors, some of the audio gear, and brings in new equipment. Functionally, it'll add a fourth camera to this room. It will increase the video quality to high definition. It will add new reliable audio, video recorders, better audio gear for better capture of sound. And more to the point, it will provide their engineers the opportunity to come in to rewire everything and to basically verify that everything is up to snuff and will continue to be so.
You don't think, Doug, I mean, you feel confident that this is not significantly impacting the quality of the upgrade, this reduction?
No, I don't. The upgrade originally...
No, you don't feel it impacts it, or it does impact it?
Well, no, the upgrade as originally presented, the $70,000+ estimate, included, for example, a new high-definition projector, which we use so little it didn't make sense. It included additional video data storage.
But we could, at some point, if we were going to use them...
We could add those later on, as we could afford them, certainly.
I just meant is the impact, total impact.
Right. No, this keeps the quality of the equipment, or I'm sorry, this focuses on the quality of the recording and the cable cast.
Okay.
So that we'll still have better quality picture and better quality sound, which is the most essential thing.
That is really what... Okay.
And reliability of operation.
Okay. All right.
The equipment that we have was purchased about 9.5 years ago. At least some of the equipment is older than that. Mm-hmm. I actually spoke with Harold Risley as to, you know, getting information as to when the gear was actually purchased. And the best we could figure is it was, I think, about 2005, 2006, somewhere around there.
It was on when I was on for only a couple of years when we did it. So
there's that. This does not exceed the amount of money that we have in the PEG Access capital account. It leaves about $15,000 or $20,000 at least in there. And I think we're still due one more payment from Comcast this year. All payments to the PEG Access have been made for this year. So I think once the end of the fiscal year is reached, we're still going to wind up with $35,000 or $40,000 still in that account. So we're not going to be completely draining the account doing this purchase.
Okay. I make a motion we authorize the bid as you presented us, the second one.
Question?
Yes.
Is this, I don't know what PEG Access is.
That's our Comcast payment from Comcast Cable to the town.
Public education program.
So we're talking about spending capital money, right?
We're talking about spending cable franchise agreement revenues, which are outside of the realm of taxation. It's not monies that are in the town's coffers.
Okay.
They come to the town as part of that contractual agreement, and the town is bound to expend those funds only for PEG Access purposes.
Okay.
They can't be used for anything else.
I've tried in the past. I've tried to angle stuff in the past.
Yes, she has.
We can't spend PEG Access money on mosquito control.
No, it wasn't mosquito control.
But we will get you a whole bunch of nickel bottle.
Diet Coke bottles, absolutely. Yeah. Sure.
Does Pepsi work?
Any bottle works.
Okay.
Mark, but you know, I drink Diet Coke. So that's what I add.
I'm just teasing you now. Come on. Give it a break.
I know. I
want to know how much endorsement you got from Coke for advertising this on TV.
Nothing. I'm not swift enough.
Government at work.
We'll just. All right. You got what you need on PEG Access?
Yes. I make
Did
a motion.
We vote it?
Yeah. No. I made a motion that we.
And we seconded it. And we had conversations.
Yeah.
Is that where we stand?
Yep. That's where you stand.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Okay. Thank
Planning
you, Doug.
Planning Board, Keats Road. Solar.
I believe in your packet you've got a request for comments. This is related to the proposal by Eagle Brook School, the Alan Chase Foundation, Eagle Brook School, to install about 1.2 megawatts of solar panels on or about Keats Road. This is a proposal that's currently before the Planning Board. They'll be taking it up at a public hearing on May 9, and they're looking for comment from all town boards and committees, and they want to know if you have any comments.
Has this been sent to the Energy Committee?
It has been sent to, I hope so. It's been sent to a lot of committees in town.
Would you check to make sure it has been? I'm pretty sure they'll be in favor of it, but it would be nice to have the endorsement of them.
Yep.
So, as a Board of Selectmen member, I...
All right, I'm not going to comment, but I'm fine with it. I thought they were exempt, but...
Yeah, I think they're too, but we're fine, the request for comments. I think it's a good program, a good... application of smart energy, and I think we should endorse it.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not saying
that's all
we don't
the
endorse
Selectmen
it. I mean,
say.
I just say that you know, they did this because of the moratorium on hooking up to Berkshire Gas, and so I feel bad for them that this has taken so long.
The advantage of this project is also that the SREC 2 cap has been lifted until the end of the calendar year, and they've got an opportunity to get in under that cap. And as long as they can get their system hooked up before the end of December, then they're going to have a great opportunity to not only make it a revenue for their for the institution, but also to save money on electricity.
Yeah.
So it's tremendous.
I certainly support it. I mean, I think it's a from a Board of Selectmen's point of view, I think we should be endorsing all of this type of thinking. So, but I think that we need to hear from the Energy Commission, see if David can give us a read on it, and make sure we're good to go. Any further comments? A review, approval, and signing of the regional dog shelter agreement.
So this is... And I apologize again. I don't know if you have this in your... Do you have this in your packet? You may
yes,
have the draft in your
I have
packet.
A draft
okay.
in the package.
This is something which I guess is a renewal of an annual contract between the town and Franklin County Sheriff's Office. It does. It is a program that has a price tag attached to it, but it's extremely small. I think it's a few hundred dollars, and there it is.
$800.
$800 per year. So it's kind of ridiculous. For the amount of good that they do, it's a ridiculously low price. And this is covered under the canine control line item, I believe.
This is a group, you know, we agreed to those that cost as a group. That's where that came from.
I'll entertain a motion.
I make that motion that we approve this contract as presented. I go to the meetings and... It is. It's a ridiculously good deal for us.
So I hear that I have a motion on the floor to enter into the agreement between the Franklin County Sheriff's Department and the Town of Deerfield regarding a regional dog officers, regional dog control services. I'll second that motion. Any further discussion on the dog agreement? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I have two clean copies. If you would please sign the last page.
While you're signing that, I just would like to say that we really appreciate the fact that the dogs are taken so well care of. Because in our case, the majority of dogs picked up are people's pets. And so they're not stray dogs. And so it's really wonderful that... such good care has been taken care of the animals.
Very good. And I'll second that sentiment. I appreciate all the hard work they do.
Thank Thank you very much for that.
Final budget review?
I've got a number of documents here. I want to give you each one of these. This document I'm handing out right now is the expense detail for the FY 2017 budget. I printed it out in color because it's actually color-coded. The gray areas are last year and the year before for any given department. The green column is the request that was made. And on the right-hand side, you see the Finance Committee review. It shows the amount that was recommended, any difference between the recommended Finance Committee recommendation and the request, and the date that the Finance Committee voted on it. Any areas that are lower than the request are highlighted in red. And the difference between the recommended and the requested is, if any, is immediately to the right.
What is the total impact of the differences at the bottom line for us?
The total impact, I'm sorry, of what?
Never mind. You did it on the back. Okay, thank you.
Okay, what?
I'm okay going to town meeting with the differences.
Oh, good. I'm not. Is there any rhyme or reason as to why they made the financial recommendations on these items? Did they give some sort of documentation to show that why it's detrimental to the town's well-being? Financially?
Some of these I can speak to, and I'd be happy to speak to because they're pretty straightforward and basic. Some of them I would actually defer to Jeff, who's here in the audience, to maybe speak from the Finance Committee's point of view. On page one, the selectmen's staff salaries, the requested amount versus the recommended amount. Essentially, the Finance Committee didn't agree with the increase in staff salary. Selectmen's salaries. That was why they voted the last year's amount. Under police payroll, the difference between the two is the amount of the school resource officer.
So they don't support the school resource officer?
At the time that they took the vote on April 11th, that was their decision.
Okay.
The Deerfield Elementary School difference, Jeff, correct me if I'm wrong, the $8,900 is the difference between what looks to be a double counting for a lease of tablets. And the way the chair explained it, it did sound like there was something really strange. Like for a couple of years, tablets had been leased and were allocated to a certain line item. And then they were moved over here in the fall, in the succeeding year. Then the year following, this year, the tablets appear back in the original place, but this location still shows them as being funded through there, and that number actually went up. So it almost looks as though it's either A, a mistake, or B, they're appropriating money twice for the same thing. And that's, I believe, am I correct? Does that sound right about?
Correct. On that,
okay.
Yes.
So that was the difference, the $8,900. Whether that will be resolved, I'm not sure.
It's a good catch.
Yeah, and if it is a double appropriation, it could very well be an honest mistake. The highway expense, the difference between the requested and the recommended, is a difference of $4,000, and I believe that that was after a request, or basically that was a reduction in the tree services budget, with the expectation that if the tree services budget does go above or goes any higher, that the highway department will come back to the town for an additional appropriation.
You mean the Finance Committee?
Correct.
So the Finance Committee's wheeling and dealing with their fund?
I don't know that they're wheeling and dealing with their fund.
If I understand what you just said, and correct me if I'm wrong, is they are telling the Highway Department to take money out of their budget and they'll cover it if it's short in the long run.
Do you want to speak to that?
Sorry, Mark, I didn't hear you.
On the general highway, you're taking $4,000 out of the budget, they're recommending $4,000 out of the budget, and it goes to the tree services in hopes that they don't spend it, but you'll give it to them if they need it later on.
I don't have my notes with me, so
okay.
I would not want to give you incorrect information.
Okay. I appreciate that. Not a problem.
Jeff, do you remember what the Tilton Library situation was? Because the Tilton Library has to cover to get their the state grant. They have to have.
Yeah, we made sure they had enough in that account
to count for the hours.
Right.
Because there's a difference of $800. Is that $800?
That's still adequate enough for them to receive their grant.
Okay.
Okay, but if my memory serves me correctly, they brought in a budget to you, and then it cut to what this recommendation or requested was, and then you cut it again?
Again, I don't have my notes with
okay.
me, so I...
Because I'm having a hard time because I've got a library and a highway department that's doing a job, and doing a very, very good job for us and providing lots of services that we need, and I've got a finance committee that seems that it's appropriate to tell them how to do their job. And I'm the double catching, that's fantastic. If it's a financial issue, that's spot on. That's exactly
everything,
what the finance committee
was. Everything was based on finances, as far as I know, with the finance committee. That was our mindset going in, and we tried to carry that all the way through. We are having another finance committee meeting tomorrow night, and you're more welcome to come to express your concerns.
No, I'd appreciate it if
Jeff, I'm sorry, I can't come because I have a Franklin Regional Council of Government Executive Board meeting,
right.
And then we have a Selectmen's Association Executive Board meeting after that. So from 5:30 till 9:30.
We covered so much material in that, and I don't have my notes with me. Represent the committee, that's all.
What I would like is that if there's a financial reason that this is supposed to be changed, that we understand what it is, just like when we asked the different departments to give us what's changed in their budget, we asked for them to tell us why it's changed and why it's important. And what we've got is a disagreement between what services should cost in the town of Deerfield for different entities. And if we have a formula that says X number of dollars, we should calculate what we put into highway and what we put into the Tilton Library, then that's great because that gives us a benchmark. But I'm reading the narratives from the different departments, and so this is why we need what we need. And what I'm getting from a recommendation of a change, but it doesn't tell me what it is that we feel like the tablets is a great, great thing to look at. And they come back and say, for whatever reason, they miscued it or they did something wrong. That's a great catch. But if we don't have something in the Tilton Library Fund, because basically my understanding of their budget was to increase services to the townspeople, and that's a decision for the townspeople. If they don't want services, they'd tell them, no, we don't want the services.
Anybody can put a hold on those, I believe, as far as when they go through and bring it to the town meeting floor.
Our mindset
on the finance committee was to look at the overall budget and have a frame of mind and try to apply it to each and every department fairly. Mm-hmm. And I know that's sometimes difficult, and I know sometimes people aren't happy with that. But like I say,
I have not heard anything from any departments. So there isn't any anger. There's no anger, or I'm a little dismayed at the fact that I don't know. You know, Doug's been there. He's got a pretty good idea of some of the things and why they've changed. But if it's a management of the department's decision as to how they want to expend the funds, it's their job to do that. If it's a financial oops or we can't afford it, then it's your job, the finance committee's job, to point out the fact that we're proceeding in error.
The finance committee, as far as the overall budget, mm-hmm. the overall expenses to the town, and trying to maintain a regional budget for each and every department, and at the same time at least be able to try to retain a little bit for either a stabilization fund or free cash. I hate the term free cash. Mm-hmm. And once again, you've got to find that balance. So how do you do that?
Yeah. But understanding why that balance is there is very, very important. And I'm not. Mm-hmm. I mean, so if you want to represent it that way, then I'm going to ask the questions on town meeting floor as to please tell me why you're doing this. I think that some of these may be very valid, and others I think are. But we have people that spend a lot of time researching what their job is, and I think that they should understand why they're being challenged on it. So we'll take this offline because I don't want to put you on the spot.
I
apologize.
I just don't want to misspeak. I don't have my notes with me, so. Mm-hmm.
I just want to make sure absolutely the library gets there. If you can just double check that.
I can actually speak to that.
Okay.
The library, you're talking about the minimum funding level necessary to keep the library.
They have that.
Yeah, they definitely have that. That minimum funding level for FY17 is $157,900 or something like that. It's basically an average of the previous 3 years' funding times 2.5% more. So that brings it up to about $157,900 or something along those lines. So the 161 or the 160 definitely meets that.
Right.
Okay.
But what is that? When you average that number out over a 3 year period and then give 2.5%, you're giving 2.5% of a 3 year average.
Correct.
Where most everybody is making the assumption, and we ask our schools to stay within 2.5% increase, you're actually penalizing the library to be in about 1.97% or one mm-hmm. point something, which is considerably less. They're not even in the same parameters that all the other towns start off at. And if the town comes in with a recommendation like Kevin has done on many occasions, that ends up saving us more money in the long run and puts more money back into the coffers, but it costs us more money to start it, or we get more in education, or we get more in recreation or benefits to the seniors and the population of the town, that you can't see it on a balance sheet. It's something dollars-wise, it's just not measurable. So I feel very strongly that if we're going to cut something, we do it, as you said, fairly and equitably across the board. And I'm not understanding it. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm just saying that with what I've gotten, I don't understand why we pick these pots. And we have very strong leadership in our departments to start carrying that forward. And I want to make sure we support them where we need to. So that's what I'm trying to understand. And again, I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'd like to understand. And I'd like to understand before I have to go to annual town meeting.
I actually had a question. What did the finance committee decide for the energy loan repayment? Is it going to be free cash or is it going to be a combination?
It actually has to come from free cash.
Oh, it has to.
Because of the way the article was written.
Right.
I'm going to take full blame for this. The article, I basically wordsmithed the article after reviewing a couple of previous funding articles and simply used the language to see if the town will vote to take from free cash a certain sum of money to pay off a loan. And instead of doing what I should have done, which would have been to see if the town will raise and appropriate, borrow, transfer from other sources, or otherwise fund.
So we're going to be short on our free cash?
Not really. The numbers as it looks like right now shows that at the end of everything, we're still going to have about $475,000 in free cash unexpended.
Oh, okay.
And the Finance Committee, I think, broadly agreed that it wasn't a great number. And I agree with that. It's not a great number, but it's really not so bad.
I'm actually not worried about it too much because I know we're going to be getting in some pretty hefty permits, and the free cash will be recertified in September. So.
Well, we're still talking about the stabilization fund, too.
Yeah.
Right.
We're not putting anything into capital stabilization and stabilization fund. So it's,
there's no plan to put anything in there.
So
but
the reality
I think
is
that
we're still not covering the... We're not finding that.
Well, what we are talking about, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, but we've only started talking about it, is the possibility of at a special town meeting in the fall, once free cash is certified, to actually put some money into capital or the general stabilization at that time.
I think
we're at least talking about that.
That's basically
when
what
we
we're
sell some of this property. Right. When we sell some of this property, I would really like to see that money transferred over to stabilization, maybe, or a capital stabilization plan.
Some of it can.
Something. So it looks like we're doing some planning.
Some of it can.
Yeah.
Yes. And I do think that's a larger conversation. Two of the guys at the back of the room will definitely be involved in some long-term fiscal planning. And I also have some more information I'll bring up a little
bit
later.
Well, I think once we get our five-year plan, a current five-year plan, then we can decide how to fund it. But I'd like to see us either put it into stabilization or capital stabilization, something. Because this is like one-time deals.
Okay. There's a couple things I would like to point out. It's on the third, I think, page, the 600 series right underneath Tilton Library. The summer swim program, the recommendation of the Finance Committee to fund at $8,000 instead of the requested $11,040. I actually agree with that. We did a review of 3 years' worth of expenses for the summer swim program, and in no given three-year period, in no given year, did they ever exceed $5,000 in expenses in any given year. The 5,200, 5,100, something like that. In addition, the summer swim program has over $10,000 in a revolving fund that has not been touched. So the rationale is that the $8,000 should be more than enough to fund what they're going to do this coming year. And if it isn't, if suddenly there's 150 people who want to have swimming lessons, the revolving fund is there to accept the fees for those swimming lessons, but also to cover any expenses. They have the authority to use that fund.
As long as we're reducing it, if they've never ever expended beyond 5,000, why are we doing 8? Why aren't we going to 5?
We figured that was enough of a drop. It's
so you're going to review
about a 35% drop, I think.
And then you'll review it again next year.
We'll review it again next year and tighten it down even more if need be. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right.
That's
a good compromise.
The other budget right there is the Tritown Beach expense, which was recommended at the same level as FY16. I concur with that as well, for a variety of reasons, which I'll go into a little bit later.
This information has been sent back to the different departments that control these.
Correct.
So that they have a chance to respond.
Correct.
Okay.
The last page shows the various and sundry articles, funding for various specific things. And the three red boxes towards the bottom that show just dashes, they do have dates for votes on them, and so those do represent actively choosing to recommend no funding for those items. I just want to point that out for clarity.
So if it's zero,
It shows up as a little dash on the spreadsheet.
On the first one on OPEB,
yep.
It shows a delta of $10,000 and it shows a negative $10,000.
Right. The delta of $10,000 represents the change in recommendation from 1 year to the next. And then the item to the right of the red box shows the difference between the requested and the recommended amount. So in FY16, we appropriated nothing towards OPEB. In FY17, the request was to appropriate $10,000. And so that's a delta of positive $10,000. The recommendation is a recommendation of zero. And so the difference between $10,000 and zero is negative $10,000, a reduction of $10,000 in the recommendation. It's kind of ridiculous in that example.
But if you do your math, where you look at your number of FY17 requested,
10,000.
No, requested. 17.
For OPEB?
The yellow column coming down.
Yep.
You've got the very last item on it. It says this is the total of warrant articles. It's $1,483,000.
I see, yes.
Okay. And on the other side, it says what they're recommending, which is 1,450.
Right.
If you subtract those two numbers, it should be the number that's between them.
Actually, yeah.
And for some reason, they're about $70,000 short.
I apologize. That number in between them represents the change.
Total change.
Oh, wow, that's completely wrong. That number is entirely inaccurate. You are not wrong.
Thank you.
Not wrong. That 100,000, that negative 100,000 is completely off. So please ignore that in the bottom of that column. That number should actually read something like 340,000, because that would represent the change between FY16 and FY17 requested. Over to the right of recommended,
yep.
There should be a number that would be about negative 33,000, negative 33,151 or something.
The difference?
As a difference between what's been requested and what's been recommended. So I apologize.
That's
an error.
That's just for the warrant articles.
Correct.
Not for the budget.
If you go back to the bottom of the previous page, those numbers, I believe, are sharp right on. Grand totals for the omnibus budget, $13.475 million, which is an increase of about $394,000 over last year. The recommended amount is $13.398 million, which shows a difference between requested and recommended of about $77,000. Of the $394,000, just really quickly scanning, education accounts for $253,000, public safety about $95,000, and town government about $82,000. And those last two numbers are soft numbers anyways. So that's that document.
All right, thank you.
I will also give to you, just for your reference, these are draft copies of the Finance Committee report that will likely be in the handout. The one-page sheet goes with the special town meeting, and then the packet is for the annual town meeting. The packet, stapled packet, is a lot of the same information you've already looked at. It's the omnibus budget, the warrant articles, the capital funding articles, and so on and so forth. So that's just there for your reference.
All right.
Did I give you both a copy of the special and annual draft warrant articles?
Yes.
Okay.
Did you give them to us, right?
Somewhere? These big heavy-duty things?
Yeah.
Okay.
We were sharing them because you only had a few copies.
Here's another set.
That's okay. I don't need any help getting to sleep.
Okay.
So these are just draft motions at the moment, right?
These are draft motions, but they have been passed legal counsel, and they've also been passed town moderator. Both Peter James and Lisa Mead were terrific in working with me to refine this language. And we're very, very close to making sure that Article 1 on the special is going to be not taking any action, because we did not exceed our snow removal budget.
Okay. I guess I would really like to look at them.
Yes, please do. Yep.
Can we post a meeting just in case we need to get together? Can we post, Mark, are you available at all on Monday before the town meeting?
The town meeting starts at 7.
Yeah, I'll be here.
Do we want to post? I think I've already posted broadly for all committees and boards to meet at 6 o'clock on Monday night. It's just a broad general posting cover everybody.
Yep.
Well, maybe you can make the selectmen's just a dash earlier. Maybe can you make 5:30, Mark?
I will try.
If we need be.
Yeah. I'll plan on being here at 5:30, so just post it.
Strongly
you want to meet here, or do we can meet at Frontier?
Yeah.
I think we should be there because we'll be all set up.
Sure.
Okay.
What I would strongly urge you both to do is to review these. If you have requests or changes or recommendations, please get them to me before Friday. I do plan to put together a packet of information for town meeting members that will include the warrant articles as well as the draft motions and any narratives, any other explanatory information, any other handouts that may be necessary. And I want to be able to have the time to present that. So whatever version we have as of 5 o'clock on Friday afternoon, that's the version I'm going to go with.
Oh, no, that's fine. I just want to, in case we have a chance.
You mean this Friday?
Yes.
Okay.
Town meeting's next Monday, so.
Yeah, so what I wanted to do, if there's any questions, I would let you know.
Of course.
And then we can meet on Monday to resolve them if Mark has the same questions or has other questions or whatever, okay? I would feel better if we had a little bit of time that we had the ability to discuss any issues, okay?
Yep.
Doug, did I hear you say you're going to ask people to meet at 6 on Monday?
No, broad tradition has been that the administrator's office basically post a meeting for all elected and appointed boards and committees that meeting to begin an hour before annual town meeting. This allows boards and committees to get together to talk about what's on the warrant and to decide as a committee if they need to take any action on it. You do not have to meet. But it's a notice and a warning to the public that those meetings may happen.
Just, so there's no violation of the open meeting law.
Exactly. It covers everybody's.
And that way, if there's something comes up that needs to be discussed, nobody's has an issue. But since we're a little behind and we haven't had a chance to discuss these really, to read them over and catch things, I would feel more comfortable if Mark and I had at least an extra half an hour.
Should I be there at 6 o'clock on Monday?
Not.
If you want to call your committee to go over the warrant or any articles on it, feel free.
John, you did a very good job. You did a very good job. So
you can feel free to do that.
As a committee member, I would say you did a very good job, and we're all sorted out, unless something comes up,
Okay.
Unless you feel uncomfortable about something, you can, have Doug email us, but.
Another slice of pizza. Well,
you did a wonderful job, and it's all organized, so it should be okay. Mark and I have not had a chance to discuss the motions, and so I wanted to read them very carefully before, and if there was something to be fixed, I wanted to make sure we had an extra half an hour.
Okay.
That was all.
I just didn't know what was expected of me.
Sure. Not unless there's a goof. But it looks like everything is organized.
I thought there was something I wanted to bring up.
On your administrator's report,
is that where we're at?
Yes. I just wanted to make sure that we did the multi-agency document. I can update Mark because we had the meeting yesterday. Mark, you had had some questions on the cost. This is the what Homeland Security has been funding, a rollout of the Franklin County Multi-Agency Coordination Center. And that's if we have an extreme event like we did in Irene. Mark was at the fire station here in South Deerfield, and I was up at the GCC Multi-Agency Coordinating Center, even though that's not, we didn't know, call it that at the time. And that was where you get resources. Like Mark would say, he needed National Guard to guard Stillwater Bridge when we closed it. And I made sure that we have made four requests. They finally found our requests and followed through with the National Guard. The idea is just you have a super center to make sure you have resources, stuff like that.
That evolution was extremely beneficial to the town of Deerfield. We got everything we asked for and was able to actually lend out some of the services we got because we had somebody there getting them out into the field. And by Carolyn being there championing that cause through, we got a lot of what we needed, plus we got enough to help support our surrounding towns. So it was a very well organized effort up there, and Carolyn was pointed out as somebody who was instrumental of making sure that we got the National Guard and the MBTA people came out. We had core group of people came out willing to work, which was nice. So,
well, what happened is Mark, as our emergency manager, put in the request for the National Guard. It kept getting lost, but I was sitting there, and we knew that was lost, so we were able to follow up on it. And the National Guard guy was sitting next to me, so he said he called his commander and said, "Look, I know she's put in the request. Can we just authorize it?" And we got it authorized, and it was that kind of stuff. It was very, very helpful. So we went to Homeland Security. I've been following it through Homeland Security. We got funding to formalize the setup. I've been on this committee. I've been going to the meetings. And as a result, we have a more formal, it's still informal, but it's a more formal agreement with GCC. We would be able to do the setup. And one of the questions was, how are we going to fund it? Right now, as a town, we pay $100 for the regional emergency planning committee to have some basic clerical support. Each town pays $100. So we're either going to increase it to $150 or $135. We haven't sorted out exactly how much a year. And that would cover the extra cost of setting up equipment at GCC on a permanent basis so that it would have one, it would be a mobile line, but it would be one phone number that would be spread countywide. So if we had an event that triggered a MAC setup, you would always have the same phone number. So it's paying for the mobile phone and the phone number to be every all year long, same every year. We have funding from Homeland Security. There's a little bit of money left over from another project. So we're going to fund setup of some laptops and some additional radios that will be stashed at Greenfield Community College. And what some of that money will go through, that $35 or $50 that every town will pay, will be for to staff a minimum three-day event that would have security from GCC. And what that would do is front the GCC money so they could pay their staff to, you know, be there or to guard the room or whatever. But it's to front the money because all our FEMA reimbursements are several months in the, you know, this would be major events. It would be more or less FEMA replacement. FEMA only pays 75%, and the state then later votes most generally the other 25%. So we would be fronting costs of like your police, your, you know, whatever, EMS, whatever is required. And then it's reimbursable to us at that point. And What this does is just pay for that GCC person or whatever the cost to GCC, because they're giving us the space, and you know, we feel like we should be paying them up front for whatever and not wait for the reimbursement. So this is the, and Mark, I'm sorry I didn't have a chance to go over it with you beforehand, but this sets up, you know, your organizational chart. This is all stuff that you're familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
Concepts of operation, activation. Just somebody has to request that a trigger.
Right.
And there's no cost to us. If we don't want to participate at that point, we don't participate. But say it was a Connecticut River event rather than a Deerfield River event, but in the going through the town of Deerfield, there was no real issues, so we wouldn't actually be activated. There's partial activation. There's standby, monitor and standby activation. There's partial activation and then full activation. And we, at any time, we choose to participate or not participate. If it's East County, we wouldn't participate. If it was West County, maybe. It depends, you know, the impact on the Deerfield River. So it's that kind of thing. So did you have any questions?
Just to recap, we're putting $35.
Well, we haven't decided an amount, but it would be something like 35 or 50.
Okay. We're going to put an amount of money into this program, part of which pays for the space we're renting at GCC to have a
security
home base, and the rest is going to go into a fund to be able to have clerical support and stuff work at a 3 days of an event. So you're going to hire somebody during the event, but we're going to actually buy a stash of radios and
that would be grant funded.
Okay.
The $35 does not do anything towards the health maintenance, health medical coordinating, you know, the new group that we're putting together from the four coalitions, the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition that I'm chair of, and the Hampshire one, and the Hamden one, and the Berkshire one is coming together under a new umbrella. We get funding through the CDC and then the state. So there's that organization is going to, and Homeland Security, the little money left over from Homeland Security on a project that we just finished, we're going to fund all the laptops and radios that will be stashed at GCC. So there's no, you know, there's no cost for that kind of stuff. We're figuring out how to do it on grant money.
Okay.
Because that was your one question, is how we're going to fund it. And that was a discussion last night, was that we're only going to have this either $135 or $150. It hasn't been sorted out completely.
Okay.
To make sure we can fund a three-day event to GCC.
That's good.
Any expenses that they incur. And security was one of them. Okay.
Yep.
All right. Then I make a motion that we, the town of Deerfield, participate in the Franklin County Multi-Agency Coordinating Center.
I agree. Second the motion. Any comments or concerns?
The only concern I have is I'm looking at the MOU that was submitted to me, sent to me. This is for the MACC. Article 5 talks about reimbursement, where if a town provides services to another town under the MACC, that they have the right to submit for reimbursement for services or equipment rendered.
That's the FEMA deal.
Yeah, it's not the FEMA deal. It's that it says within 60 days after conclusion, the responding town. Let's say if we responded to Greenfield to help them out, we would be the responding town, may submit to the requesting town for reimbursement.
What sometimes, because what happens, say we participated in a shelter event, or say it wasn't directly impacting us, and say we sent up one EMT for one shift, okay?
Sure.
We would not meet a threshold, all right? So what we would do would be we would be have the ability to bill Greenfield or have Greenfield reimburse us. That's what that language refers to, especially it is concerning the meeting the minimum threshold for reimbursement when you have a FEMA declared event.
Okay, so in other words, if there's a FEMA declared event in Greenfield and three surrounding towns respond with equipment or staff and they tally up the costs that they expended for that equipment and staff, the understanding is that if Greenfield, let's say, applies to FEMA for reimbursement for disaster relief. We bill them, and that's part of their request.
That's their part of their request. Because remember, the FEMA amount is only 75% reimbursement.
Sure.
And you're hoping that the state will come with the other 25, but it's not guaranteed.
So the expectation is not that if we do mutual aid response for a fire that happens over the line in the next town over, that automatically we're going to start billing each other every time we respond and help folks out.
No.
Okay.
No.
It has to be a declared disaster.
And it has to be something that you submitted money to, that you got reimbursed for.
Okay.
You know how they retro do some of the snowstorms?
Sure.
Okay. If we lent out a piece of snow equipment.
Sure.
One snow equipment and one operator for 6 hours, we're not going to meet any threshold to participate in a reimbursement. However, if we lent it out to Greenfield that had something more snow than Deerfield, for example, or whatever. I don't know how you do it. But anyway, say we lent it out to someplace further east, to Orange, okay? Then Orange, when they go to, and they're in close enough to be included in that FEMA reimbursement,
yep,
or the declared emergency by the governor, then they could put in for their reimbursement, and they would put in for our share, which we wouldn't qualify for normally, because the threshold, if you have no threshold on costs, you don't get back, you don't get no money.
Okay.
So if we are participating, the idea is to frame the billing so that we get reimbursed.
Fair enough. Okay.
And that's why it's wording that way, because sometimes it's better to group it together, you're going to get reimbursed.
Sure.
If you go individually, nobody meets the threshold,
yep,
then nobody gets reimbursed.
Yep. Okay. Fair enough. That's the only question I had.
Okay.
I have copies of the agreement for you to sign.
Actually, you know,
vote on it.
The police chiefs and highway departments, and you know, we're getting really swift on how to get reimbursement. Mm-hmm. So it was put in there so that we have flexibility.
Good.
Okay.
Okay.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. There's a place for you to sign on the back page. Please sign both copies and date them today. I'll make sure they get back to where they need to go.
Oh, you have a pen. Yeah. Thank you, Doug, for taking care of this, because Mark and I have been working on this for quite a while. A couple of years.
More Carolyn.
Well, it was one of those things that we felt it was really important and it was advantageous to the town.
While he's doing that, I'll quickly touch on a couple of different things. I had a first meeting with Joe Markarian, who's the consultant that's working through the FCOG to help us make good on our community compact promise to reestablish and restore our financial or fiscal policies. Joe had some really, really great ideas, and he also understands that we're at a very busy time of our year with town meeting coming up. And a change in the board, a new member coming onto the board. And so we're going to be getting back together again in a couple, 3 weeks. But what his recommendation is, and my recommendation to you, is that when it comes time to start doing work on fiscal policies, that we develop a working group that includes a cross-section of select individuals from a lot of different boards and committees to talk about and to really explore the idea of what these financial policies should look like. He concurred that
policies are set by the executive authority in the town. But he also said that without buy-in from a broad section of town residents and committee members and board members, then the policies are ineffective. And so he sees a process that will extend 2, 3, 4 months. And at the end of it, we won't have policies that will tell you what form to use or, you know, the people you need to talk to or the timeline, but it will tell you, broadly speaking, where, you know, what things you should be paying attention to. It's more like the interconnections between departments or the 30,000-foot picture that we're constantly talking about, and not how a specific board should operate in regard to any given matter. And so in that way, I think we're definitely on the right track.
Did you tell him that we had made a commitment to start a capital stabilization?
Yes.
Meeting. Okay.
Yes. And he understands that not only is the capital stabilization plan a part of a good fiscal package for any given town, he suggested that the policies should actually come first, which does bring up some questions. And I'm reiterating some of this from
memory. Do you have some material for us to discuss on the 25th? I mean,
May 25th?
Yeah, maybe you could send it to John for a review or...
I will see what I can come up with. We didn't really have any material. He didn't present any material to me.
Well, maybe you could request that he, okay, since he talked about the need to have policy, maybe he has some templates for policies.
He does.
Okay.
And he's going to be working on, he's not really building templates, but he's going to be working on some questions that the town is going to need to answer. And the answers to those questions will help to drive the,
well,
the construction of the template.
Well, if you could forward that information to John, that would be very helpful because,
sure.
John, if you don't mind, would you let Doug forward that information to you just to preview it before our meeting on the 25th?
Would it be beneficial if he attends a meeting on May 25th?
I plan to.
No, not
you. Oh, Joe, I'll talk to him about it and see if he's able to.
I mean, it's the first. We're just going to be getting our feet wet. But
sure.
Maybe the best time for him to be there.
Right. The my understanding, though, is that really the policies are like this much higher level discussion. For example, how do you fund capital projects?
Well, I know, but I think that's a fundamental question.
Not just who's got ideas or where they're going to go, but how do you fund them? Do you fund them from free cash? Do you fund them from a stabilization fund? How do you feed money into your stabilization fund? Where does it come from? Is it tied to a percentage of your operating budget? Is it tied to a percentage of your free cash? Are there minimums? All of these things are, he didn't give answers to these questions, but he suggested that these are questions we need to ask first and foremost.
I know.
You ask him if he thinks he could be of help. So we need to leave it up to him.
In terms of helping develop the capital plan, you mean?
No, just sitting in the first meeting, say, here's how other towns put one together.
Sure.
Here's how we should act to do it.
Right. Well, and I do believe that the CIPC is going to be a key player in this because... absolutely, the members of that committee, the members of the Finance Committee, the members of the Planning Board, the members of the Board of Selectmen, just to name a few, will all have a role in talking about where the town is going and what their recommendations might be. A long-term capital plan is tied to a long-term fiscal plan, is tied to a long-term plan for development in the town, is tied to the executive authority and the executive's decisions as to what where you want the town to go. These are all part of the same conversation. So I will extend the invitation to him and let him know when and where.
How about if you send me his email and I can, do you mind if I communicate directly with him?
I will check with him on that. I don't know how he wants to communicate yet.
Okay.
But I will check with him.
All right.
Yeah. So that happened. and it was a positive conversation. I felt confident that he's going to be of great help for us in the future. The next thing I have on my list is some concerns I have about the Tri-Town Beach. This is a bit of an uncomfortable conversation for me. I asked a series of questions to Beth Foley, who brought them to the Tri-Town Beach Committee Commission. At their meeting, they discussed the questions, and the responses I got back were detailed enough. I'm not satisfied with them personally. Coming from a private sector, I would definitely not be satisfied with them.
some of my questions included, do you have any numbers of Deerfield residents that use the beach? The answer is no. I said, do you have any record of how many people came to the beach last year? The answer is no. I said, do you have any information as to who bought passes and how much was spent on passes? The answer is no. I said, do you have cash handling procedures? The answer is no. I said, would you consider buying a cash register? The committee discussed that and voted no. I asked, how is cash handled? And the answer is, well, someone comes and gets it at the end of the day and makes a deposit. And to me, in my mind, the fact that there's checks and cash being handled, that no receipts are being given, that there's no record of what is being purchased, that's pretty terrifying.
Are you sure there's no records?
I asked, and they said we have no record. We have no record as to how many passes, not even how many passes were sold or how many people bought them. I was asking for more detailed information, like how many Deerfield residents bought passes. And they basically said, well, the amount of money we took in is how much money we put into the bank. I have concerns. I would be happy to codify those concerns in a letter. The recommendation I was given was to communicate to you those concerns and to have you reach out to the Whately Board of Selectmen to have a conversation about it. I don't know if you want to do that.
I think we should. Having basic information. I mean, how can we vote money, town money, and fund this if we have no information?
Right.
And that's separate from the cash handling and deposits and receipts and all that.
Right.
I'm certainly not saying that there's any issues, but apparently, you know, not having information makes me feel uncomfortable. Because how do you justify spending money? I mean, we just went over the budget.
Sure.
How can we spend town money without accountability?
Mm-hmm.
And I know Beth has told you that she's concerned, so, you know, passed on her concerns. So
yep.
I think based on her not being comfortable, I think we just need to do something.
Mm-hmm.
So I appreciate the fact that it is awkward, and we're certainly not accusing anybody of anything, but we should have some accountability.
Absolutely.
Especially if we're going to fund it another year. I don't know how we can recommend to town meeting to fund it if we don't even have that basic information.
Same way we've been doing it for the last 4 years. We've let this dog run wild, and I don't mean that in a derogatory, but we've let them set their own standards. We're going to take away their funding now at the 11th hour without having us go through the process?
Well, I think, Mark, that we were aware that there was no information. I mean, we had concerns about not information being passed to us, but Doug specifically asked for that information.
It's supposed to be given to us in an annual report with as every subcommittee and every committee that we have, and we have not
ever
asked for it. And if we stopped asking, they stopped giving. I think that we should hold ourselves as much responsible as that committee, but shame on us, and let's figure out how to fix it.
Perhaps the tack to take will be a reiteration of the requests, but not as a request for the information, but as a statement that we will be expecting reports that include that information.
But wouldn't that come out of the meeting with the other town board of selectmen?
It certainly could.
I think that we're in a partnership here.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Just go ahead and vote the
money and just sit down and have the meeting and sit down and have the meeting and say, hey guys, you know,
we expect this
is what should have been done all along. We're not asking you to reinvent the wheel. This is what does in every other department and anything we do. This is the way we do business.
Correct.
If you need help, we'll give you examples or whatever, but we are expecting to get this information. And, you know, we have some records because we have what we've expended. And that's all in the accountability of personnel hours being paid because we write a check for it.
Mm-hmm.
So we know somewhat of where our money's going, but the reality of it is we haven't really dug in to help
codify what it is we expect from them. And I think both boards need to get together and mend the weave of how we get this thing to work correctly with both sides, both towns agreeing on how we do it.
Okay. I'm fine with that then.
Then I will extend that request to Mark Perhinsky and ask him to extend it to the Whateley board for a meeting early to mid-May.
Yeah.
Right now, the beach is not doing anything except looking to hire folks for the summer. They're not actively open. They may be spending money on doing some basic water testing, but otherwise they're not expending money broadly. So there's still time to basically say, no, here's how you're going to do things.
Well, they're still on
They're spending last year's money.
But it isn't necessarily just a fiscal year, you know, budget to budget, you know, responsibility. We want to know that their operations are being conducted in a responsible way.
Right, and we should know what, you know, because usually, if my memory serves me correctly, this was reported out many moons ago because they used to keep back about $1,400 to get the beach ready because it went from this fiscal year into the next fiscal year.
Sure.
So you couldn't spend all your money by the end of the summer.
Sure.
Because you'd have nothing to get the beach ready before.
Right.
For the first couple of weeks of their season is in this fiscal year. So we just need to figure out how we want to attack this beast.
My understanding and my recollection is that somewhere between $6,000 and $8,000 has been spent so far this fiscal year. So that leaves about somewhere around $6,000 or $7,000, maybe a little bit more, that they still have in their account unexpended. That should easily last. Well, I won't say easily, but that should definitely last through July 1st.
Yeah.
My concern is also the fact that the beach was closed for a number of weeks last year. And we can talk to the health department in Whateley because she keeps the records on those.
Yes.
But if you plan to fund salaries for 10 weeks and you're closed, say, 2 out of those 10, then the expectation is that you're only spending 80% of your salary line item.
No, it depends on how the policy is set up. If you hire somebody for a 10 weeks commitment and no fault of their own, we're held to the contract of what we... I mean, it'd be like you walk up and saying, I want you to work for me for the summer, and the kids are going back to school, or it's a part-time job. In the middle of it, you say, oh, I'm sorry that we let the beach get contaminated. You guys don't have a job for the next 2 weeks. You may never reopen if you let them go. And they don't know from day to day whether it will reopen or not. So they can't say, hey, don't come in today. Don't come in tomorrow. Don't come in today and keep pushing them on.
They might pay them whether they're open or not.
But in the same token, there's plenty of things that can be done to enhance the organization.
Sure, sure.
So they could be working on things of painting or structure that would be acceptable during downtime that you're not going to get done before the season starts because the kids are and
that's a good people point,
are,
Mark.
Are in school. So again, we don't want to micromanage how they're doing business. We just want accountability. We want to understand why. And if we had 2 weeks or 4 weeks that was not productive, what are we going to do to make sure it doesn't happen again this year, that the beach stays open and that it stays to be a valuable component of providing to our townspeople?
I did ask several questions related to staffing. I said, if a person is given time off, are they paid for it? And the answer was no. I said, if a person doesn't work a particular shift, are they paid for it? And the answer is no. I asked if there was any sick or personal time that was granted to any of the people who work there for the summer, and the answer is no. There's no sick or personal time, or vacation time for that matter. And so I felt confident that at least in that sense, they're paying people to come to work.
Right.
You're absolutely right that even if the beach itself is closed, maybe there's raking of the sand or there's cleaning up of the facility.
Well, if you had water quality that was bad, or there was in what past years they have geese that had made it so you couldn't walk on the beaches, then you can't open up with goose poop everywhere. So they had to close the beach and collect it and get rid of it because that would contaminate the water. So we need to understand with a narrative what it is you're doing and why it's that way. So I think we've beat that horse just about as dead as we're going to get it.
Yep,
so
there it is.
Let's move on.
Thank you, Doug, for taking
care
of that.
Sure. I have two other things. One is hopefully easy. Sometime back, the board in Deerfield made a capital grant to the local access TV station to support a change in location, to support efforts to either renovate a space or to make a purchase of a space. At this point, the board of the PEG Access of Frontier Community Access TV has determined that they will not be making a purchase of space in the near future, and they would like to know essentially what to do with the money. It's been sitting in an account, untouched, unused, and they would like to know if it should come back to the town to be redeposited in the PEG Access Fund, or if it may be used for other purposes to be approved by the Board of Selectmen.
How much is it?
It's $80,000.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah,
well,
it's significant.
I don't know how you feel, but I would think it should come back.
I think that basically it can only be used for PEG Access. So whether it sits over there in that account or sits over here in our account, you're not going to spend it on anything other than PEG Access. And we've got $37,000 we're going to have at the end of this fiscal year. I think that basically I'm hoping that
is it
we
an
can
escrow?
Move.
Is it an escrow account that it's sitting in, or how is it sitting
it was,
in?
I am not privy exactly to whether or not it's in a separate physical bank account. It is being accounted for separately.
Right.
So it's considered like a separate
fund.
It's
a capital.
Yeah, capital
well,
fund.
Well,
a capital improvement.
Find out how it's sitting and then make that decision, Mark. If it's separate for a place. Well, I don't know. I mean, if it's for any capital expenditure, I guess I'm okay with it because
they have to come back and ask us for it. It's in an earmark account for them to buy a place to move into. For them to move it anywhere or move it back here, it's going to be in this. We account for it on our chair, on our books, or they account on theirs, but it's in PEG Access money. I really hope that they can find a home that's suitable for what they need to be doing.
Okay.
And I'm hoping that we can actually start working towards that in this next year. Because I think we're spending money on renting.
Do they know what they're going to do? I mean,
no. It's they've done a search committee. They've worked very hard in trying to get a space. And with today's technology, you can buy a space, and then everybody does everything from home, and you got a space that's not used. You could use that office over there and run everything you need out of that space. But you may have to upgrade that space to be functionally and technically capable of doing it. So it's one of those things. No, the air conditioning works very well in that
room.
Yeah,
it's nice and cool in there.
That room's very good. Yeah. But the whole thought process is the fact that, and again, PEG Access or Frontier Community is a community of four towns now. That puts together a great program, and I would rather they look at what are their fundamental needs in the next 18 months and explain to us what they want to do and how they want to go there, because to sit dormant or to take the money and move it back here, we're just closing the book on the thought process that they can't get any better. So I think that we should just encourage them to keep it in a place where it's safe, and
sure,
look at where are they going to go with this, and how do we get our kids and our seniors and people involved in community access, because basically it is our community and how we prove it. So
I would definitely reiterate the fact that this room is a great example. Put three or four cameras in this room, which we have, and microphones, and you have a space within which people can express ideas and opinions. If you look at the Sunderland Public Library, their meeting/presentation room is a great space, and with the addition of a couple of cameras, you now have a very capable forum for expressing ideas and having people talk about different things, topics, whatever. You could play music in that space. It's not so much about having a studio, it's about bringing technology to places where things are going on.
So you're on that committee for us. Do you feel comfortable with that recommendation then?
I can tell you that there are certain capital needs that FCAT has. Right now, the broadcast server that was purchased about 6 years ago, it manages the cable cast for all of the channels, channels 12, 15, and 23, is getting very old. It's getting very tired, so much so that it's at times it's non-responsive. Trying to program it to play shows, it doesn't respond. Takes a long time. It's laggy. And that's one thing that is being looked at is a replacement for that piece of equipment. The board has generally said, yes, it's something we need to do, but the board has not said, yes, go ahead and make the purchase.
How much do they have in capital? Capital stabilization or capital reserves or anything?
Probably about $45,000, which is not a whole lot of money.
No. Bumping into this with all of the startup programs that we're doing, and FCAT, even though it's been around for a fair amount of time, it's still a startup. It's still growing.
Sure.
It's not hit its peak of what it's going to be, the ambulance service. But if you look at the ones that have been around for 100 years, if you look at the South Deerfield Water District or the South Deerfield Fire District, they rely on their monies from taxation, just like everybody else does. They've got, I'd say that either one of those you pick, you're going to find it's got at least their whole annual funding in the bank.
Yep.
And they need that to make sure that if something catastrophic happens, they can cover their bets. And they have run you don't see anybody out there running around looking to hang these people up by their thumbs because they've got money in the bank. As a matter of fact, I think most of us like the idea that these people are fiscally responsible and able to do this. I think that the other organizations should model a little bit of that and have capital funding in there to make sure that the stuff that needs to get fixed or repaired or kept current is that way. And we should encourage them to save money in capital stabilization, and a bank account of some sort that's, you don't want to call it free cash, call it whatever you want to call it. The proverbial piggy bank, so that basically they're not killed from a single event.
Doug, I think everybody contributed right to the capital count to do that move, right?
The request was made of all four towns.
Right. So maybe you can pass on the request that Deerfield is, say, willing to allow them to keep the money, and maybe they can request the other towns to keep the money there, too, as a capital count.
I think that the procedure is such that if any of the towns ask for it back, they consider it to go back to... it's equally put back into the funds, but the reality is...
Well, no, I think you made a good case, Mark. And so I would just pass on that maybe you would ask all the towns to keep their money there as a capital.
Well, and rename it if they need to. Rename it to a capital,
A capital account.
Capital account or a stabilization, capital stabilization account, so that basically... because sooner or later, this is what I'm talking about. Sooner or later, that server, and I'm assuming that server probably comes in at around $34,000 to $60,000.
You're in the right neighborhood.
Dies tomorrow. They're running off of laptops and base computers with terabyte.
No, Mark, it makes sense because they would just come to us and ask for it.
They're going to come ask for it anyway, so
it's fine.
And
but
they're doing a good job.
I would just ask Doug to pass on the request that all the towns keep the capital there.
Absolutely. I
think that's a good suggestion.
Yep, I do know that the other towns are looking at doing the same thing that we're doing here, which is to upgrade their in-building or in-office resources for their government programming, and that's going to eat a lot of capital. But I also know that we are still expecting to sign a renewal of the contract, the franchise agreement, and that will bring a new infusion of capital into all member towns as well. So that'll make a big difference.
They've done a good job. They've been good stewards of the technology.
Okay.
So
that's great.
Anything else, Doug?
The last thing I have does relate a little bit to an article on the town meeting and a little bit towards the discussion that we had earlier about the Wastewater Study Committee. And that's the name of it now, the Wastewater Study Committee. There is an article on the annual town meeting to appropriate monies for the Headworks project.
What article is it?
Annual town meeting, Article 10, I think.
Okay.
I think it's 10. Yes, it is.
Okay, so what's the deal?
So the article basically says to provide some or sums of money for the so-called Headworks project. This article was going to be a larger article to authorize borrowing to actually pay for the Headworks. But given the town's, given the board's decision to go with the study committee to basically shift to downshift, to go into low gear and to proceed a little bit more cautiously, relating, you know, on matters relating to upgrades for the plant, we've revised the draft language for the motion. What I'm looking for is confirmation that this represents what you're looking to do. The $130,000 will do certain studies. It will fund the design. It will allow us to continue to get the resources that we've been getting from Weston and Sampson. To be honest, it'll pay for some services that we've already received, but it will position us very, very well as we go forward and look to apply for grant money and USDA loans and that sort of thing.
Is Kevin okay with Headworks being delayed a bit?
He kind of feels that it's out of his hands.
Oh. Well, that doesn't help us make a decision. Is it appropriate to be delayed? I thought this was a little bit more. We had to have had this.
Well, both he and I are pretty confident that this is an essential upgrade that needs to happen as soon as possible, because it does represent a functional step forward in the right direction, and it is the first step, regardless of what we do or don't do with the system, the overall wastewater management system.
Jeff, do you feel comfortable having your committee make a decision fairly soon on the Headworks? I mean, because you're one of the ones.
I think we'd have to see what the costs were and the associated costs. The 130, I believe, Doug, we've already approved, correct?
We have not. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. CIPC, the Finance Committee and the CIPC have approved the 130. Yes, I apologize. Yes. Yes. The Finance Committee recommends it. The CIPC recommends the 130.
So do you feel as a committee that you could...
And that's going to have to be the committee's decision.
Oh, no, I agree. But do you feel that you can take this up relatively...
Which committee are you talking about?
The Waste Committee.
Wastewater... Study committee?
Study committee, looking at this relatively quick. I mean, knowing that this is
it really does.
Timeline is a little bit more compressed for this particular part of the overall.
The committee could address.
Okay.
Initially, when they first meet, because obviously I don't think anybody's going to argue that's not a priority. So I think that's something that could be reviewed right away.
Yeah, I'm not pressing you. I'm just giving general feedback. Are you willing to have a more compressed timeline on a particular aspect?
Right, on that particular item, I believe so.
Then I'm okay with this. How about you, Mark? Are you okay with this?
I think we're arguing over who gets to throw the first pitch instead of discussing how we fix the game.
Well, no, that's why we have the committee, so that there's more people having discussion.
Once the committee meets, once all we have is that article, nothing's going to happen until next annual town meeting. We've got nothing to do other than have Weston Sampson do more studies.
We have no authorization to fix anything or to move forward with anything.
If they're willing to look at this in a more compressed timeline than just sort of out there, then we have the ability to have a special town meeting where we could address. Yeah. Or something.
We should change our annual town meeting to the fall and try to pretend we're doing it in the springtime so that we push everything back to the fall. Because that's when everybody wants to discuss the things we should have been discussing right along.
Well, the problem is we don't always have, the spring is, to make everything happen in April is very tough. That's all. I mean, given the finances that we are living under, it's hard to make decisions. You have to put them off sometimes.
This is 25 years in the making. How much do you want to put it off?
One thing that we can proceed forward with is a MassWorks grant application, and part of the $130,000 is to allow Weston and Sampson to be that fiscal agent to basically help us apply for that grant. We'll be better positioned to maybe receive it if we can make a good, strong case that this is something that we desperately need.
Can you just remind me, is that $130,000, does that include what we're going to owe them by December if we don't?
That covers basically their fees through December.
Okay.
And that's the majority of the design fees. That's the majority of the consulting that we're getting through them. It's actually a number of different things through both.
Then I'm okay with that, because the whole point was to get to the point where we could apply for a grant.
Right.
And we needed to cover their costs because they weren't fronting it for 2 or 3 years like they did before. And that's fine.
If by some weird quirk of fate we actually qualify for a MassWorks grant, there we are. That's our appropriation, and we can run. If we have to go to USDA Rural Development for a loan, we still have to get approval to do that from town meeting.
I know, but that gives time for the committee to sort things out.
Okay.
I really do appreciate you volunteering to do so that there's more people looking at this and thinking about it. Okay. I mean, I really do.
This is going to be a big help for the entire town, for all the residents.
So I do too.
You have me on there too, right?
Yep.
There's 7 people on the list.
I really do. And I didn't mean it. I know you're going to be involved from a capital point of view, but I am really appreciative that you're willing to go to a few extra meetings to have input on this total overview, because it's substantial money.
I don't believe people want to drag their feet on this. I think what people feel is they just like to have more information so they can move forward.
What I was concerned about is that we just get in a position enough so that we have enough information to apply for grants. And if, I mean, because
our understanding was 130 would do that.
All I did was talk to some people, and that's where I came up with the 20 million. And then we got some information from the engineering, and it was what? You know, another half again, at least. And so we really need some more information even before you can apply for anything, realistically.
I have nothing further. I would like to remind you of 2 things. One is we have the warrant to sign, and the second is I would like to request an executive session for purposes of discussing negotiations with non-union personnel.
The only other thing, I don't know what I did with the agenda. There was you have meetings for the 25th, the town meeting. You might want to post the Wednesday in case it goes over, Doug.
It actually would be Thursday.
Oh.
Monday, Thursday, and Saturday.
Oh, okay. Well, whatever that second date is, you might want to list that. Is it already posted?
The Thursday is not posted, but if by the end of Monday night the meeting is still going on, we'll have time to post after that.
And I think our meeting is May 4th.
Wednesday the 4th, correct. Do I have it incorrect on the...
You have May 5th.
Very good. Yep.
That's the only reason I... because there was another meeting May 5th I've already committed to, and I was like, wait.
I think you're absolutely right. Okay. We'll change that. Yep, that's it. Just a brief executive session.
Can you take a couple of questions from the floor?
Sure.
I think it was last week when you were going over the special special town meeting articles. I asked why you had a special town meeting, and I was told that it's so you can get monies that were being expended into fiscal year 2016.
That's traditionally why we set up a special town meeting. But
why is the infamous Article 6 in a special town meeting?
Article 6.
Close to the annual town meeting.
That was at the request of the town moderator.
Do you know why he did that?
You'd have to speak to him. I'm not really sure.
Okay. And are the motions going to be available to the public? And if so, when and where?
They've gone through legal counsel after this meeting with the comments I've gotten from the board.
I thought we decided to take
I'm going to need a day to make sure I've got everything square and straight, and once again to get final review from legal counsel and town moderator. I will probably try to make them available through the website. I'm not going to print anything more until I print out the packets for town meeting.
So when will that be?
The packets for town meeting will likely not be printed. They're going to be printed over the weekend. They'll be available on Monday.
So not before then? Not.
Well, again, I can post the final versions of the motions on the website.
That's
so
okay.
Folks can take a look at it there.
Any idea when that will be?
Hopefully by Friday.
Okay.
I'm going to need at least a day to make sure I've got my
what did we decide? My
P's and Q's in order.
All right.
Did we decide to do something?
Thank you.
You know, I thought there was. We decided something on Article 6. Am I imagining that?
Article 6 of the special?
Yeah.
I think you're taking no action on that.
Yeah.
Am I wrong?
No, I thought we were not taking action.
I think you're taking no action on that.
John, we're not taking any action on that. No.
Okay, thank you.
Remember, that's why we formed the committee.
Right,
you know,
makes
the,
sense.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yep. Yeah. So,
no, it doesn't, but that's
okay. But in general, we were always told that the special town meeting is for you could pay bills this current,
mm-hmm.
for this current fiscal year. But I guess what the new thinking is as long as you listed it, is that right?
For this? You specify where the money gets appropriated and how in the article and in the motion.
You don't have to have the...
You don't have to have it separated it out. I think it was the intention of town moderator to always have the annual town meeting be essentially the same from one year to the next, and all exceptional or odd requests get put into a special town meeting sequestered over there.
You know, that might change because Peter's retiring and somebody wants to do something different. Who knows? But we're not taking that any action on that article.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you both for volunteering, and thank you, Trevor, for coming again.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Great. Did I hear correctly that they suspended the pipeline?
Yes.
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 Does that mean like for a week, or do you?
Well, as I found out. You know, you have to. We're gonna finish filing all our remarks.
Good.
And all that kind of stuff. But I was just gonna say that right here is the news release. Did you have your copy?
Here's an NPR.
Oh, you heard it.
There's a copy of the news release from the recorder right there on the table.
Great.
Oh,
yeah.
Great.
Yeah. It's. I think what it was, the intervention. Montague was intervening. And the expert, well, I mean, we don't, because it's confidential, we'll never actually know
why.
But there was enough information that the lawyer and the expert witness were able to dig up that when the expert witness started testifying, the contract, the basis of the contract became in question.
Right.
And the moratorium, of course, was in question. And so there goes that was the major reason to have the pipeline go through there was that. And, of course, Berkshire Gas is owned by the Spanish company that wanted the exports to happen and
sure.
whatever. So, anyway, I think there was enough information there that they knew their contract was falling apart because that's what the basis of it was. They didn't have enough to FERC has actually turned down a couple pipelines now because they didn't have enough local
right.
contracts.
Right.
So. They were afraid of getting turned down, and it was easier to suspend it and say that they're suspending it on their reasoning rather than have FERC turn it down, because then it was dead.
Can we? I'm sorry. I've been up since 5 o'clock.
Me too.
This is the third time I've heard this conversation, and I would really appreciate it if we could just get through our agenda. So
thank you very much for being here, Trevor.
Thank you.
Have a nice night.
Sure.
Thank you so much for coming.
Sure.
So I will entertain a motion to move into executive session.
To conduct strategy sessions in preparation for negotiations with non-union personnel.
I vote aye. Or second. I second it first, and then I vote aye.
Any further discussion? Mark Gilmore in favor?
Carolyn Ness, aye.
Entering into executive session at 10 p.m.